Need to rediscover their best form fast. When you harbour serious ambitions of reaching the Premiership and have just lost two on the trot, the Stadium of Light is without question the last place you want to visit. But that's where George Burley and co find themselves today. Two facts will lend them comfort. Despite their recent wobble, they still have the best defensive record in the division, 17 goals conceded in 27 games, and they've lost only three of their last 28 on the road. But Sunderland have lost only one of their last 36 at home, scoring 84 in the process. That is the extent of the challenge facing Ipswich today. It's one of the most impressive grounds in the country. The average attendance this season, 37,500, and that makes Sunderland the fifth best supported team in the country. Only Manchester United, Liverpool, Arsenal and Aston Villa have better averages. Can Ipswich cope in the cauldron today? It's our biggest game of the season so far. First against fifth, and a win for Ipswich would take them back to second, where they've been for most of the season. Ray and Nigel are geared up for this one. And joining them today is Trevor Francis, whose Birmingham team are also in the thick of the promotion race. Currently fourth, a point ahead of Ipswich, eight behind Sunderland. So which result would suit you best today, Trevor?
Well, I think it's been recognised for a long while that Sunderland are the outstanding team in the league. They're on course to get the first position. They've obtained more than 2 points a game up to now, and they're on course to get close to 100. So I think they'll win it. So we're all hoping today that Sunderland will win the game. Except if you're an Ipswich supporter.
Absolutely, yeah. It's certainly hotting up at the top of the table, Nigel, isn't it? With Bolton and Bradford in particular going from strength to strength as well.
It is hotting up, and it would be even hotter if Ipswich do beat Sunderland today. I'd make it very close at the top. As Trevor said, he really wants Sunderland to win and break away at the top and leave that second place open. But if Ipswich do win today, it could be very interesting.
Well, Ray, you are an Ipswich convert this season. Can they do it this afternoon?
Well, I thought they could, and then I was reading the stats given to me on my way up to Leeds yesterday, and I saw that Mowbray wasn't playing. And I've changed my point of view on the game. I think Mowbray would have been vitally important to them, and I think it's going to be very difficult for them today.
OK, well, there is plenty to look forward to as we build up to a 1 o'clock kickoff. Dave Bassett has gone back to training, this time as Sky Sports spy. He's been finding out the secret of Sunderland's success and talking tactics with town manager George Burley. We've all the first division goals from yesterday, including more Mills magic for Bradford. A double take for Dean as the twin earned the win for Bolton. And how proud Pompey proved that there is life after death. No one in that coffin, by the way. Now, we start with yesterday's game at Oakwell between Barnsley and Trevor's team, Birmingham. Finished 0-0, but a fair amount of incident, Trevor.
Yes, it was a good performance by our team. We're slightly disappointed we didn't get the 3 points. This is their best effort. That was given a goal kick when actually our keeper, Kevin Poole, made a good save there. We've come close here. That's a deflection from the fullback, Eden. The keeper, Bullock, makes an excellent reflex save.
Disallowed goal now.
Yeah, at the time I thought it was offside. It takes a deflection off Richardson here and falls to John McCarthy. Actually, one of their defenders later confirmed to John that he played him onside.
Really?
So when I heard that, I was obviously more disappointed.
I bet you were.
This, well, I felt at the time that it was a penalty. I think Ferran was about to shoot, and you can see there Sheridan, who came on his sub, takes his back leg from him. and absolutely nothing was given. So one or two major incidents, you know, didn't really fall for us yesterday, didn't quite get the rub of the green. This is an incident where it falls to Michael Johnson. Took a slight deflection, beats the keeper, but crashes against the crossbar.
This is our last chance.
Adi Bola gets clear, uses terrific pace, and the keeper makes a good save.
But would you settle? Are you happy with a point at a place like Barnsley?
We would, I think before the game, possibly a draw we'd have accepted, but when you look back on the chances that we created, I think we'd have preferred obviously the 3 points. It's disappointing when you come away having just got the point, you see what the other teams have done, you feel you've done well, then you look at the league table and you've slipped from second to fourth.
It's very tough at the top. One of the sides doing so well at the moment, Bradford City, who've made it 7 wins in 8, Ray, after defeating the bottom team Crewe. They were in front after 24 minutes. Wayne Jacobs' cross, Lee Mills with the header.
What a cross as well. This is a fantastic ball. Mills just pulling off the defender and a fabulous header back from where the ball's come.
It was to be...
textbook stuff.
Yeah.
And there this man's in form, isn't he, Lee Mills? Shrugs off two defenders and a fabulous strike there past Kiertan.
He really is on fire at the moment after a slowish start, thoroughly enjoying himself.
Yeah, that's right. But I think Bradford have now really come into their own. I think the signing of Stuart McCall was a wonderful signing from Paul Drill. This is another man that is in wonderful form, Robbie Blake. Gets a little bit of fortune here, goes down the outside. The cross is slightly defected. Kiertan gets a punch to it, but look at this. Now, that is a centre forward in form. Lee Mills there striking an unstoppable volley. Textbook stuff, look at that.
And that's the first hat-trick of his career. Now, between them, Blake and Mills have scored 15 of Bradford's last 16 goals. Blake finished third in the December Nationwide Player of the Month competition, and when you see him do that, it's no surprise.
He's played very well, hasn't he? He moves the ball all the time, which makes it hard for the defender to defend, and finishes off with a wonderful strike.
Crewe's consolation came 17 minutes from time there. Three subs combining, Smith, Unsworth, and then Colin Little with the final touch.
Yeah, I thought this might have been offside. Doesn't really matter. It's obviously game over. But as we see the ball coming across here, I just think this is offside.
Not so another disappointing result for Crewe, who won 3 and lost 3 of their last 6, but they still have a chance of avoiding the drop. Now, along with Bradford, Bolton are going from strength to strength at the moment. They picked up 3 more points yesterday at Sheffield United. Nigel, United taking the lead after 33 minutes. Andy Campbell still on loan with his first ever league goal.
Yes, he's been out injured as well, but Graeme Stewart picks up the ball in the midfield. First time pass, sets him free, and this is a young lad, plenty of confidence here. Across the defender and smashes it in the back of the net. A good start for Sheffield United.
He'll have enjoyed that, but 3 minutes after half-time, Bolton were level, Scott Sellers' corner, and Dean Holdsworth in at the back post.
Yeah, I think as we see it again, I think Alan Kelly decides to come for this, doesn't get there. I think Fish flicks it on. And this is a good header from Dean Holdsworth, just looping in the corner against his brother David.
Sheffield United had a good chance to go back in front when they won themselves a penalty. It's Paul Warhurst on Marcelo.
Right, for me, that's a definite penalty. Paul Warhurst doesn't have to slide in there. Marcelo's going away from the goal, and it's a definite penalty. As he cuts it back, he takes his feet away. And then up steps Wayne Quinn. And unfortunately for him, Juicy saves it with his feet and then picks it up.
And that rather sums up Sheffield United's luck at the moment, doesn't it?
It does. I think they've missed, 3 or 4 penalties this season and missed enough last season as well.
It was a very costly miss because 18 minutes from time, Bolton got their winner. Per Fransson with the initial shot. The goalkeeper can't hold it and Holdsworth slides in for his and Bolton's second.
That's a real striker's goal there, sniffing around the box. Per Fransson's goal, shot. Alan Kelly can't hold that. Maybe should have done better there, Alan Kelly, but there's Dean Holdsworth just to win the game for Bolton. It's a big win for them.
Trevor, Bolton had that indifferent spell October, November time, but they and Bradford are very serious contenders now, aren't they?
Well, Bradford's our next game is home in 2 weeks' time, and they're in terrific form. At the start of the season, they didn't start particularly well. I think it took a little while to get some of the new players into the team. I think he's bought well, Paul Gill. You know, we talk about young managers, but at this moment, you get my vote as the manager of the season. He's had an outstanding season. But Bolton are my other tip for the automatic spot. That was before the season started, and I've got nothing to change my mind.
There are so many contenders, aren't there, basically?
Well, there's about 8 teams that are all involved there, but I think when I see the strength of Bolton, they've got some Premiership players there, and I think they're the biggest threat to us.
Well, another side who few people mentioned, certainly at the start of the season, are Grimsby Town. 6 wins in 7 for Alan Buckley's team, Trevor. Yesterday, 1 goal against Oxford was enough.
Well, I think since they've come back into the league, along with Watford, the two teams who got promoted last year, they've done exceptionally well. That's a good cross and Groves yet again. I mean, for a midfield player, I think that's his 13th goal this season.
That's right. Goalless at Molineux, right?
Yeah, two players not on the same wavelength there. That's Keith Cole's pass to Simon Osborne, and Mika Hyde's shot is well saved there by Stoll.
Robbie Keane might have won it for the home side.
He's in wonderful form, isn't he? Again, moves it onto his left side. He just misses the goal there. I thought he'd have hit the target there, Robbie.
Norwich have lost their way just a little bit as West Brom find even more resolve on their travels, Nigel.
Yes, Norwich have lost their way a little bit, but I think they'll be counting their losses there, because that should have been given, in my opinion. That's a goal.
Llewellyn heading the ball out of the goalkeeper's hands. We'll have another look at that in a moment. Llewellyn thought he'd scored. Instead, he ended up with a yellow card.
This is a free kick from Bortolescu. Ray's friend, and takes a deflection there off, I think it was off Marshall actually, and went in the back of the net.
That was after 50 minutes. Norwich equalising 12 minutes from time.
Yes, I think they've actually missed Bellamy, I think, Norwich. I think since he's been out of the team, he's such a wonderful player. I think they missed that drive forward, and they want him back as soon as possible.
Lee Marshall with the equaliser. Now, the Portsmouth supporters carried a coffin before yesterday's game against Huddersfield, saying the club must not die. Turned out to be a good afternoon for them. Trevor, 3 points at Huddersfield's expense.
Yes, and it's an exceptionally good goal from Claridge. We all know what he can do in possession of the ball. He's twisting and turning here, trying to get his opening, and then that's a brilliant finish. Curls it into the far post, and an excellent goal.
They've had so many problems of a financial level, Portsmouth, but do you think they're strong enough on the pitch to survive this season?
It's going to be tight. I mean, we're talking about the top, you know, tight it is, but it's also quite tight at the bottom, and it tends to change from week to week. But I think Portsmouth have just about got enough to stay up.
OK, well, Trevor wants to have another look at that disallowed goal for Norwich. There have been a few examples in the past. George Best's goal a few years back in particular. I mean, should that have counted, Trevor?
Well, I think it should have done. I think the referee there, Mr. Bill Burns, when he sees that again, will probably think that he made the wrong decision. I think if you raise your foot there, that could be deemed dangerous play. But he's come in with a header. He's only got one hand on the ball, and I think that should have been allowed.
OK, interesting. We are, of course, building up to our live game at the Stadium of Light this afternoon. Sunderland looking to extend their lead at the top of the table. 7 points clear at the moment. A win for Ipswich will lift them from fifth to second. But after the break, it's the rest of yesterday's First Division goals, including a sweet header for Crystal Palace's fan Z that soured Stockport's day at Selhurst Park. At the Stadium of Light. Now, Sunderland have had the upper hand in recent years. They have lost only 2 of the last 8. And Ipswich haven't had too much success in the North East recently. Their last win at Sunderland was 10 years ago. David Lowe with 2, Simon Milton and Jason Dazelle scoring in a 4-2 victory at Roker Park. Last season, they managed a 2-2 draw at the Stadium of Light. Bobby Petter put them in front after 11 minutes. Darren Williams equalised just 2 minutes later. Kieran Dyer made it 2-1 before half-time. But Kevin Phillips, who else, salvaged a point. At Portman Road last April, Ipswich dealt Sunderland's automatic promotion hopes a killer blow.
Craddock under pressure from Johnson, good play from him. Holland arriving! Vapin's teasing ball for Matthew!
But at the start of this season, Sunderland did gain a measure of revenge.
Gray has burst forward to pick it up from Johnston, 3 in the middle, and Mullen arrives and scores! Phillips this time is onside, one-on-one with the goalkeeper, 2-0.
Well, we've got the rest of yesterday's First Division goals coming up in just a moment, but let's now get all the team news from the Stadium of Light with Alan Bentley.
Thank you, Marcus. And we saw Alan Johnston and Michael Gray in prolific form there against Ipswich at the start of this season, and they are both back from injury. That's the big news as far as Sunderland is concerned. Here's the team in more detail for you. I say that the big news. 3 Michael Gray after a calf strain. 11 Alan Johnston out for 7 games with knee trouble. They are both back. Just as well, too, with Darren Williams and Gavin McCann suspended. Up front, well, 9 Niall Quinn, a new 3.5-year deal secured. He's alongside a fit again Kevin Phillips. Phillips playing 10. 4 months out with a toe problem. A goal on his return last week. Still no Nicky Summerby, incidentally, a shin injury for him, though he does start training in the coming week. As for Ipswich Town, if we can look at them, Tony Mowbray and the influential Bobby Petter are banned. So youngster Titus Bramble comes in at 5. Jim McGilton on loan from Sheffield Wednesday replaces Petter at number 11. Fabian Vilnis, the latest Dutchman to represent Ipswich, is at number 2. He made his debut last week. And up front, David Johnston, number 9. He's on 48 league goals. That's it. Back to you, Marcus.
Thank you, Alan. Let's continue with a look back at yesterday's First Division goals. Our next port of call is Selhurst Park. Steve Coppell back for his third spell in charge of Crystal Palace. Stockport were the visitors yesterday, and they began exceptionally well, Raymond, didn't they, in front after just 4 minutes.
Yeah, Brett Angel's having a wonderful time, isn't he? It's Izzy Moore just doing very well there. Gets the ball. I actually thought that was an own goal, but Brett, being the centre-forward he is, claims it. 14 goals this season, 10 coming in 13 games. That's fantastic stuff, Marcus.
And he was Flynn to get another one after, yeah, 23 minutes.
Yeah, that's right. He gets it back here. And this shows his power in the air. He's terrific in the air, his Angel. Making it 2-0 there for Stockport.
At that point, Steve Coppell was thinking, what am I doing back in football management?
I wasn't sure he was thinking that at all, Marcus. He's probably loving it, if the truth is.
Actually, I heard a radio interview with him after the game, and he said that's what he was thinking.
What? He was loving it?
No, he was wondering what he was doing back in football management. But he started to enjoy himself a minute before half-time.
He certainly did. That's Attilio Lombardo getting up on the back post. And you can't often see Attilio head the ball, but that was a great header there for Clinton Morris. This is more than what we see from Attilio. A great ball there, and Transy levelling the scores there, 2 apiece with Palace.
Good comeback for the Palace. Can they keep hold of Attilio Lombardo there? That's the big question they have to resolve in the coming weeks. Now, Bury have been on a bit of a free-for-all decline in recent weeks, Trevor. At home to Queen's Park Rangers yesterday, and they took the lead early on.
Yeah, it's Nigel Jensen back in the team who gets the flick on. QPR don't deal with a big ball down the middle, and James gets in for the goal. This is a great cross from Peacock. Just plays it into the danger area, and Dowie reacts before any defender to get the goal.
Rare goal for Ian Dowie. Point apiece at Ashton Gate, Nigel.
Yes, Alan Mahan, again, his fourth goal of the season, is in form at the moment. And I think Tremor had a good time away from home. I think that's only one defeat in 11 games away from home.
Quite right.
But obviously Bristol City needed the points more. That's a great finish.
Adam Locke securing the point for Bristol City, who aren't winning enough games. Lovely day at Port Vale, right?
Yeah, but a lovely run there from Jordan Dyer and a terrific finish. He sees that Ty Gooden isn't really going to get the crossing too well, and that's a great goal.
Well, Oxford are back in the relegation zone after their defeat at Grimsby and Bristol City's point at home to Tranmere. There's then a 4-point gap to Portsmouth, but only 2 points separate them and Tranmere in 16th. Swindon look now to be well clear of trouble. Sheffield United have faded badly in recent weeks. Wolves, Huddersfield and Norwich are struggling to keep in touch as well. Grimsby replace Watford in the playoff places. Then, as we've seen, it's Ipswich, Birmingham, Bolton, Bradford and Sunderland 7 points clear. The two Lees lead the way in the goal-scoring charts. Mills up to second following his hat-trick, and as Ray mentioned, Brett Angel has scored 10 of his 14 goals in his last 13 matches. Don't forget, you can see the goals from all three nationwide divisions in our Football League review. That's at 5 o'clock on Sky Sports 2 tomorrow, and it's repeated at 11 o'clock on Sky Sports 1. Well, it's time now to take a closer look around the Stadium of Light in the company of an ardent Sunderland supporter. Martin Brammer was lead singer of 80s band The Cane Gang. This was their biggest chart success. And since then, he's written a string of hits, including Lifted for the Lighthouse Family.
Hi, my name's Martin Brammer. I'm a songwriter. I'm in my studio in Kentish Town working with James Taylor. And I used to be lead singer in the Cane Gang. But on a weekend, ever since then, and even now, I'm an ardent Sunderland supporter.
Welcome to the Sunderland Stadium of Light. This is my theatre of dreams. So this is inside the fantastic Stadium of Light, but it's even more beautiful when it's full of 42,000 screaming fans. This is the home team's dressing room. This is the little warm-up area. And through here, you can see the lovely, calm, cream walls that were specially recommended by a sports psychologist. Now, this is the away team's dressing room. There's no warm-up area, and it's full of cold blue colours, all part of the psychological battle. This is where Reedy sits. This is the pie-proof glass here. And this is a phone to speak to the bench, so maybe I'll give it a go. Any chance of a game, lads? And this is where all the posh people eat. Bet they don't have burger and chips in here. This is one of 54 lovely, warm executive boxes where you can shout, "Away the lads," in style. Here we are in the boardroom of the Stadium of Light, and I reckon it's the best penthouse suite in Sunderland.
You've now seen all the facilities that we've got within the Stadium of Light. We think it's the best stadium. The club, on and off the pitch, is now well geared to get into the Premier League, and we hope that we can sustain, stop there, and maybe look for a bit of silverware and a bit of success in the future.
I often dream of leading a Sunderland team out into a frenzied Stadium of Light. For me, that would be the closest thing to heaven.
Martin Brammer crossing his fingers and hoping for three more points for Sunderland this afternoon. Once again, they're the country's top scorers, 57 league goals, and their 57-point tally is the best in the four divisions. And look at that stadium. It has to be one of the best in the country. Another full house expected today, of course. After the break, Dave Bassett, who's joined our team recently, is talking tactics. Plenty to look forward to this afternoon at the Stadium of Light. What are the bookies make of it? Sunderland 13-8 on, Ipswich 7-2, and a draw 13-5. And I imagine pretty short odds on Kevin Phillips and David Johnson scoring today, both back after injury, and they are two of the hottest properties in the Nationwide League. Well, there they both are. Kevin Phillips back last week, his first start in 25 games after a foot injury. Inevitably, he scored his ninth goal in 11 games. It's 44-59 for Sunderland. And David Johnson returned at Christmas after an operation on his knee. 11 goals so far this season. And Trevor, he's been linked with a move to West Ham, which I suppose is inevitable, bearing in mind his form over the past few months.
Who's this, Johnson or Phillips?
Johnson.
Johnson, yeah. I mean, he's an essential part of Ipswich's team. I think that since Scowcroft has come out the side, obviously they've missed his aerial power. And I think Johnson suffered also, because I think since he's come back after that cartilage operation, I think I'm right in saying he hasn't scored, but he's a very dangerous player, very quick, and a good goal scorer. I think the difference is, though, between the two teams is that, you know, Phillips has been out for a long while, yet they've got the likes of Di Chio and Bridges who can come in to replace him.
That strength in depth. Having said that, they were delighted to get Kevin Phillips back last week for the game at Queen's Park Rangers. Rain, it took him, what, half an hour to score another cracking goal?
What a wonderful goal, didn't he? Danny Maddox let him get across the front of him and Kevin put it in with great aplomb. But I think the thing that assists Kevin immensely is the fact that he's got... It is the little and very large act, isn't it, with Niall Quinn. I think Niall Quinn is just a fantastic foil for Kevin Phillips. The problems he causes to defenders, the ball drops down, and Kevin, being as bright and as lively as he is, he's always there to wrap in the rebound. And I think they've got the perfect partnership.
I think also, Ray, if I just come in there, the fact that Amon Johnson is now back playing, that's also very, very good for Sunderland, because I think he's essential also, you know, to the front line.
What about Niall Quinn, Nigel? He came close to retiring from football not so long ago with various injury problems, but he's been banging them away again, although he's had a bit of a quiet spell recently, and he's signed a new 3.5-year contract.
Yeah, good for Big Niall. I mean, he's such a tremendous player at Arsenal, and then he's gone up there to Sunderland, obviously Man City on the way, but he's such a big lad that for Phillips it's a great foil for him, and when Bridges plays, he's a big foil for him as well. He's a target man. If they've got nothing else on, they can just hit it up to Big Niall. But he can finish as well. He's good on the deck. People don't give him credit for the way he can play on the ground for a big man. He's dangerous in the air as well. He's an all-round player, and Reedy knows him very well. He bought him at Main Road, and he's bought him at Sunderland. This is a wonderful finish, leaving it over the keeper. And when he's in form, obviously Sunderland play so well. But having Phillips back as well, I don't see there's anything to stop them.
He's a much better footballer, Marcus, than give him credit for, Niall Quinn. Much better.
OK, well, no question about Sunderland's threat up front. But Peter Reid has been delighted with his defence in recent weeks. And the latest addition to our squad, Dave Bassett, has run the rule over their back four in the first of his Bassett briefs.
They've given me a real cracker for my first assignment, a freezing cold Wednesday morning in Sunderland. I'm hoping things are going to warm up as we go through the day. I'm here to check out the back four of Makin, Butler, Melville and Gray, one of the most successful defences in the country and one that will take some beating on Sunday. I was wrapped up warm against the cold as I took to the field in time to catch Reedy taking the players through some early warm-ups. One of Sunderland's main strengths is the way they track back when they lose the ball. We can see this here with Michael Gray chasing back and eventually regaining possession. We can see the benefits of this in the game situation here. Sunderland have lost the ball. They've got their back three narrow and Michael Gray is tracking back, eventually forcing the mistake. A bit later on, Peter was kind enough to let us watch him take the back four through their paces.
Thomas, you keep them out of the box. Don't let them go in the 18-yard box. If the ball goes out to the winger, you fly out. You get out there as soon as you can. Mel, in the hole. Mick, drift across. Leave the fireman's spare. Anyone drops off in your areas, right up the... You get in behind, defend narrow. If there's anywhere there's any danger, make them go wide.
Here we can see the importance of Sunderland's fullbacks. Michael Gray closes space quickly in a dangerous position, wins possession and immediately gets forward. Unfortunately, on this occasion, the shot is poor.
Working the strikers back towards their own goal. All right, let's go. I get it! Hold them up there. And relative to where the ball bounces, that's what you go. I mean, it wasn't the greatest of headers, so you can't steam right out. You've got to look where the ball bounces and react from there. Let's have another. How's your head this morning?
This clip shows what Peter was talking about. A long goal kick into the Sunderland half. The defender heads a good clearance. Back players immediately push up, winning the knockdown and therefore setting up Kevin Phillips for a goal. After training, Peter and I continued the tactical talk about his defence in his office at the training ground.
I mean, that's just specifics on the back. Yeah, Peter, obviously you like to get your fullbacks forward, and in a situation where this might be Gray or Makin, for example, and it's played out to your wide player, and then possibly the ball is lost. Now, what are you expecting from your midfield players and your back players now?
Well, in the team, we've got Kevin Ball, who'd be a holding midfield player. But basically, what I'd try to do is go and attack the ball, and Kevin would then get in areas relative where the ball is, move across to protect in here. And when we lose it, one of the main things is that everybody's got to get back. The most important thing then is to get back in a defensive position and hunt the ball in packs. And that's what we do. I mean, Clark, you'd be trying to get in. Mickey Gray had obviously come back. And whoever's left side, if Alan Johnson's fit or, you know, we play someone in there. It's important to get back. Someone would be tucked in as quick as you can, and you'd get your defensive shape as quick as you can. They would try and attack the ball to hold them up, get in areas, and Kevin Ball's my insurance in front of there. Kevin's the one who rolls in the middle of the park, lets Clarkey get on with it, Alex Ray get on it, whoever's playing in there, and we just have him as an insurance in the middle of the park, and he's done it great for us up to now this season.
Well, that was the thing we were concerned with highlighting for Sunderland. Obviously, you've got more tactics to your team, but I appreciate you showing us, you know, basically what you're looking for your defenders.
Well, it's been a pleasure. Been a pleasure. No problem.
Interesting stuff, and we'll hear more from Dave with George Burley a little later on. The Sunderland defence haven't conceded a goal at home for 7.5 hours. But, Ray, how highly do you rate their defence? I know in the past you've said that if they were in the Premiership, they might find themselves in a little bit of trouble.
Yep, I think the majority of sides, no disrespect to Trevor's side as well, that once you make that step up into the big league, not so much the inferior defending of the First Division, but the much better forward play of the Premier League. And I think that's where the likes of the Sunderlands might have a little bit of a problem, in that there are top-class forward players in every Premier League side. I know they've knocked Everton out of the Worthington Cup over a couple of legs, but I just feel that the step up is immense.
Would you agree with that, Trevor?
Well, I've often said that there's a massive gulf between the Premiership and the First Division. I think that's been confirmed in recent Cup games. I think for any team to come out of this league and go into the Premiership, they would have to change their playing squad. But you think about that when you get there.
Get there first,
the most difficult thing is to get there. And the second issue is, once you're there, you start to think about changing things.
OK, well, just behind the Sunderland back four is their goalkeeper, Thomas Sorensen, who's been something of an unsung hero this season, not back in his native Denmark, where they're making an 8-part television documentary on him. He's kept 19 clean sheets in 35 games. He's pushing Peter Schmeichel for the goalkeeper's position in the national side. How highly do you rate him, Nigel?
I rate him very highly. I think he's a tremendous goalkeeper. He's only 22. Let's not forget that as well. He's got a lot of years in front of him, but I think he's made a big difference to the defence of Sunderland this season compared to last season. And he's full of confidence, and I think he's going to be in the next Danish squad. And as you say, against Croatia, and most probably he will take over from Schmeichel, and I think if he can learn a little bit off Schmeichel, he's going to be a wonderful goalkeeper.
We could be looking at, actually, the best two keepers in the league. I think that Richard Wright is an outstanding keeper, and this lad, as the lads Nigel's just said, has done very, very well this season.
Mm. Well, Sorensen is December's Nationwide Player of the Month. Richard Wright here has kept more clean sheets than any other goalkeeper in the country. Ray, we have spoken about him before, but he keeps living up to expectations, doesn't he?
He's a wonderful goalkeeper, isn't he? And I honestly feel today that he has got to play on top of his game for Ipswich to have any sort of chance of getting something from the match. Phil Parks spoke about him 4 or 5 years ago to me and said that he was the best young goalkeeper in prospect that he had seen around for a long, long time.
Well, another star in the Ipswich side is the very versatile Kieran Dyer. Still only 20 years of age, he's on the fringe of the full England team, and he is the subject of the second of Battitt's Briefs.
Well, here we are today at Ipswich's training ground, where the conditions are better than they were yesterday. As you can see from the practice match that's being played, that the conditions are infinitely better. And we're here today to look at Kieran Dyer, a very promising player who a lot of clubs are well aware of, and Ipswich regard him as a prize asset. In terms of considering the potential of Kieran, the first thing I'd like to discuss is his physical attributes. Here's an example. After the Grimsby attack breaks down, Kieran is the first to the ball. A quality pass and he's on his way. He shows fantastic pace, and had it been a better ball from Petter, he would have been in on goal. Obviously, midfield players have got to have other things than stamina, and in Kieran's case, he's got an excellent first touch and his control is very, very good. That's due to the fact that he's got very good feet, and that enables him to have good coordination and balance.
and that helps him when he's linking up the play. This is a good example of what I'm talking about. Kieran collects the ball in the middle of the park, good first touch and pass, which gets Ipswich on their way. Another quality ball, and it's just a shame the cross is poor. George Burley is obviously well happy with Kieran, already an established England under 21 player. George kindly allowed us into the dressing rooms at Portman Road to discuss his talents in more depth.
Yes, I mean, Kieran's got so many qualities. When you look at the system we're playing with three at the back, five across the middle, Kieran can play here, here, or anywhere in midfield. For England, for the under-21s, I know Glenn Hoddle likes him in that position.
Yeah.
Because he can defend, he can attack, very comfortable on the ball, will create chances. Where we use him for Ipswich, we tend to push one a little bit forward, and Kieran having the licence to go and get the ball. And another thing which people don't realise what he's good at, closing down. We talk about closing teams down. Kieran is one of the best players actually for going closing people down, because he's so quick and agile, he can actually get to people, close them down, take it off them, then start attacks. He should score more goals, he will score more goals, but certainly with his energy and his ability to go forward, that will come.
Yeah, I can see you selling for about 250,000, George.
Well, I mean, I might be biased, but as I say, I think he's probably one of the best young players in the country. I know Glenn Hoddle and John Gorman think that way, and we're very pleased with him. He's a local lad, he's came through the youth team, he wants to learn, and there's still so much for him to keep progressing in the game.
Well, Dave Bassett certainly clocked up a few motorway miles during the week. Now, Ray, a few weeks ago, you described this guy, Kieran Dyer, as being as versatile as an egg.
Well, I think George just said exactly the same, didn't he? He can play anywhere. Glenn and Peter like him playing as a wing-back on the right-hand side. But I think this fellow is dynamic. I think he really is a super midfield player. And he does have tremendous feet as well. He's a good passer of the ball. And we saw that run he made against Grimsby there. That was 75, 80 yards. And he really is as fit as a butcher's dog, this chap. And I'm a great admirer, Mike. I think he's premiership material.
Is he an England player of the future, Trevor, do you think?
I would think so. He's been one of the most impressive players for Ipswich this season. We were just discussing, prior to starting, that there are some good players in the First Division, and he's certainly one of the players that have come through their youth policy. They spend a lot of money on the youth policy at Ipswich, and they're reaping the rewards, the likes of Wright, Scowcroft, and this guy here, Dyer.
Well, Nigel, alongside him in the Ipswich midfield is Matt Holland, who is so consistent. 93 consecutive appearances now for the club.
Yeah, he's a good jockey as well, I think. Well, he's got a good horse, as we saw the other
that's
week.
That's right, yeah.
Matt Holland, but that's tremendous. I mean, not missed a game since coming from Bournemouth, and he is a good midfield player. He does a lot of work in there for Kieran, allowing Kieran to get forward a bit more. But it's going to be a big test for the pair of them today against Sunderland, because Sunderland with Lee Clark and Kevin Ball in there, who are strong players, it's going to be a difficult battle for them today. But if they can get forward, I think Kieran's only scored 3 goals this season. I think he really should be scoring a few more goals from that position.
They're going to have to cover every blade of grass today, aren't they?
They are. It's going to have to be a good team performance, and Richard Wright is going to have to play well, as Ray said earlier. But we're looking at a very good game, and obviously with Johnson back for Sunderland supplying the crosses, it's going to be an interesting one.
OK, well, let us now have a word with the Ipswich manager, George Burley. He's talking to Alan Bentley.
George, a couple of defeats, a couple of suspensions, a couple of injuries. Is this a real testing time for you at the moment?
Well, I mean, I think this season lasts, for 9-10 months. It's a consistency all the way through. At the start of the season, we've been very consistent. As you say, we've lost the last 2 games. A little bit unfortunate against Wolves, but to be fair, we're poor against Grimsby. So I'm looking for the character of the side to bounce back.
You brought in Jim McGilton on loan. What does he add to the club?
Yeah, I mean, we've got a very young team. Jim will give us experience. He's a good passer of the ball. We've got a couple of suspensions today, so he'll certainly strengthen our squad.
And when we saw you win at the back end of last season, to me the key battle was Kieran Dyer and Holland in midfield against Ball and Clark. Is that the key battle today in some respects?
Yeah, it's a key battle, but Sunderland's got so many good players, we'll have to be the best all-rounder side. But we're coming here, we're looking for a win. We know if we win today, we're back in second position, so that's what we're aiming to do.
Thanks a lot, George.
Thank you,
George. It is a very young team. How easy, Trevor, will it be for them to bounce back from those 2 defeats, do you think?
Well, I think they've suffered because they've not had the strength in depth. You know, if they were to take a few suspensions and a few injuries, we always felt that Ipswich, perhaps, it may be the reverse. Whereas last season, they came so strong in the second half of the season, perhaps they may have one or two problems. I think since the start of the season, they've had to sort of let players go because of their financial restraints. They've made a decision to keep the likes of Wright, Scowcroft and Dyer, but they've allowed, I think it's something like six or seven squad players to leave the club, so they really are bare now when it comes to numbers. And that's the reason why they've had to take in players like Magilton, they've had Abu recently, and then they've had something like four lone players this season, so that's an indication that they haven't quite got the strength and depth of the likes of Sunderland and one or two other clubs.
They were 15th at this stage last season. Their two recent defeats have been very narrow ones, one goal deciding both matches. Nigel, this was a live game of ours at the end of last year. It was just one terrific goal that beat them, wasn't it?
It was a tremendous goal from Muscat, but I think Ipswich were the better team and were unfortunate to lose the game. But they're not scoring enough goals, and I think since James Scowcroft has been out with that broken collarbone, they've suffered for it, losing at home. Here to Grimsby, and
we thought the keeper might have been fouled for that goal as well, didn't we?
Well, Ray thought he might have been, but I think he's come for it and been blocked off a little bit. But they sometimes go for you, sometimes against you. But that's a good win for Grimsby, but a poor one for Ipswich, and they've lost at home to Barnsley as well. So with Scowcroft being out, it really does leave a lot of weight on Johnson's shoulders up front, and he scored 10 goals. Scowcroft scored 10, and then I think Kieran Dyer's the next one with 3 goals. So they do need somebody to come in. And young Richard Naylor's playing today, so they'll be looking to him to find the back of the net.
And Ray, presumably it'll be fairly easy for George Burley to G them up at the Stadium of Light, or is there a danger they may just freeze in such surroundings?
No, they've done very well away from home, and I think they'll do well today as well. They play some very, very good football. Young Bramble comes in once again. We saw him make his debut against Sheffield United, had an exceptional game, but this is a different game altogether. The crowd will be 40,000+, and it's going to be a fantastic atmosphere. And I hope that they can handle the situation, because we should be in for a classic.
Well, the atmosphere is certainly building up. They're expecting a crowd of around 37,000-38,000. They've got a live band on the pitch, the Commandments. He's enjoying himself. Goodness me. I wonder if Peter Reid is in such good spirits. He's now talking to our reporter, Alan Bentley.
Peter, with such a healthy lead in Division 1, how do you guard against complacency?
Well, you can't win anything in January. It's impossible. I think it's a good game because Ipswich are one of the best teams in the league and play good football, so we're going to be at our best to win the game. And the players will be up for it, no mistake about that. If they don't perform, I've got other players who can get in the side. So, you've got to play well here or you don't get in the team.
I mean, people forget this season. You've had tremendous injury problems, haven't you, along the way?
Yeah, I mean, we've had real bad ones. Phillips was his first game back last week, and we've missed Clarkey. Well, the list goes on, but it's the strength and depth of the squad which has pulled us through. And the spirit among the players, which is fantastic. That's what pleases me. And I mean, you don't play well in every game, but I know they're going to give me everything they've got.
Good news, say Alan Johnston and Michael Gray back.
They are terrific news, yeah. It's a massive boost for us. Delighted about that. And delighted just watch England win the cricket, and you're interrupting me watching that, but brilliant result for the English lads in Australia.
Thanks, Peter.
Pleasure.
You want to know.
Typical of Alan Bentley, always butting in when he's least wanted. That cricket, of course, was over on Sky Sports 2, England beating Australia by, I think, 7 runs in Sydney, so that was a great start to the day. What is going to happen this afternoon then, Trevor? We know you'd rather see a Sunderland victory. Is that going to be the case?
Well, I think so. I think that Sunderland are the favourites, rightly so. Their home form has been outstanding. But I think Ipswich, I think the lads mentioned this now, that without Mowbray, I think that's a big loss to them, especially playing against big Niall Quinn. But I think in Richard Wright, they've got an outstanding keeper. He comes off his line, takes a lot of crosses. And I think that with Johnson back in the team today, I think they'll be trying to supply a lot of crosses for Quinn. So I think that Richard Wright is an essential part of the Ipswich team.
OK, but I'm going to put a home win down against your name, is that right?
I'm happy with that.
OK. Nigel, 2 correct predictions out of 3 so far this year. What's it to be this afternoon?
Yeah, I'm flying. I'm going to have to go for Sunderland, I think. But if Ipswich can keep Sunderland quiet for the first 20 minutes, that's the most important time. If they concede an early goal, I can see there being a few goals in this, but I think I'll go for Sunderland.
Come on, Ray. Ipswich convert. Go the other way.
They've only scored 36 goals, I think, this year, Ipswich, this season. But I honestly feel if they can get enough ball up to Naylor and Johnson up against Melville and Butler, who are 2 big lads, but these 2, Naylor and Johnson, are very, very quick on the floor. I think they could cause them a few problems. I'm going for a draw.
Going for a draw, good man.
Can I just say that it'll be interesting to see if Ipswich actually, you know, approach this game, because they have been second for most of this season. It's the first time they've come down to a fifth position. You know, so they're playing under a little bit of pressure. I think next week they're in the cup, so there's no league game for them next week. So if they don't get a result today, they play again in 2 weeks' time, they could be, you know, a little bit down the league.
Yeah, it's a big afternoon for them, no doubt about that. So two home wins and a draw, according to our experts. We'll remind them of that at half-time and full-time. But it's now time to say a very good afternoon to our match commentators, Alan Brazil and Rob Hawthorne.
Good afternoon, and what a tribute it is to Sunderland that their challengers haven't really eaten into their lead too significantly, despite a recent dip in form and a catalogue of injuries that really would have floored lesser sides. The returns after injury of Michael Gray and Alan Johnston give the Sunderland team a more familiar look today. Gray missed last week's draw at Queen's Park Rangers with a calf strain, while Johnston has been out for a month with a knee problem. They come back at a useful time because of two suspensions collected in the FA Cup win at Lincoln. Gavin McCann, who got the winner that day, also picked up his fifth booking of the season, while Darren Williams was sent off. Seven of this starting lineup also started the 2-0 win at Ipswich in August, including Kevin Phillips, who scored then and again on his comeback last weekend.
Yeah, certainly a biggie, Rob. Sunderland 4-4-2. Not been playing superbly well the last few weeks, but getting results. But they know how important this one is. Macon, Melville, Butler, Michael Gray. Gray will be delighted to have Alan Johnston back in front of him on the left-hand side. And now the ball with us. Ball wearing four. Clark, playmaker, and Ray can also dig. They'll be looking to try and stop Dyer and Matty Holland. Up front, tremendous pairing. The target man, quality. Great experience now, Quinn. And the little pocket rocket, Phillips. Tremendous. Great to see him back.
Like Sunderland, Ipswich have two players missing through suspension. Tony Mowbray and Bobby Petter, who scored here last season, have both collected five bookings. Manuel Thetis, incidentally, is one away from his 11th caution and an early appearance before the disciplinary mandarins of the FA. Titus Bramble, who made a mature debut in front of the cameras in the win at Sheffield United, gets the chance to shine on an even bigger stage. And Jim Magilton, on a month's loan from Sheffield Wednesday, makes his debut.
Yeah, certainly Jim Magilton will enjoy this. 42,000, big game for him. With Richard Wright in goal, I agree with the guys in the studio. He could be very, very busy this afternoon, but he'll relish that. He is top class. Thetis, Venus, and Titus Bramble. Bramble, what a game for this kid against now Quinn and the little fella Phillips. Clapham in front, left wing back. Vilnius, right wing back. The three across the middle are going to have to work hard today. The classy Dyer, great engine, great going forward. Holland, who might just sit in front of Venus to try and protect his back three. And Magilton, who will be busy, good passer, busy midfield player. Up front, Naylor gives 100%, will try to close down, work the line well. And Johnston, who's looking for a goal. Johnston needs to get back to the sparkle, been out with injury, but he'll relish this big match.
An atmosphere to make the hair stand up on the back of the neck of the most experienced professional. Indeed, Kevin Phillips admits he's missed that as much as anything else during his recent layoff from the team. An atmosphere to inspire, or an atmosphere to intimidate opponents. Ipswich gained a 2-2 draw on their only previous visit here. They're under pressure after recent defeats. Can they do it today? Find out after the break.
Here we go then, one of the most eagerly anticipated games of the season. Will Sunderland march on, or can Ipswich fight back? It's time to rejoin Alan Brazil and Rob Hawthorne.
It's September the 15th since Kevin Phillips last turned out at the Stadium of Light, got injured in that Worthington Cup game against Chester. It was a worryingly long absence, and Sunderland have done well to stay ahead of the pack without him. But typically he marked his return with a goal last week. Sunderland can go 10 points clear at the top if they win here today. But it's the visitors, Ipswich, who'll be hoping to close the gap to 6 points, who get the match underway. They're starting from their lowest place in the league table since the end of October. The weekend's results have seen George Burley's side drop down to fifth. Melville concedes the throw, and David Johnson might take a long one. Of course, it was from a long throw in that John McGreal scored the own goal
that took Ipswich into the fourth round of the FA Cup. And it's a long effort from him here to put Sorensen under pressure from Richard Naylor. The linesman's flag's up. I think there's a free kick been given here, but Naylor will chase these all day. It's very, very windy here at the Stadium of Light. Look at this for a throw. Sorensen gets under it, and I don't see anything at all wrong with that. Naylor climbing really high. The right arm's up, but that's a good leap for me. Referee saying free kick. Richard Naylor very much making the most of his first team opportunity in the absence of James Scowcroft. Ipswich still notably under strength. Scowcroft has been out for a while. Mickey Stockwell only just on his way back towards first team duty. Yeah, I spoke to James earlier before the game, James Scowcroft, and he's still 2-3 weeks away. Collarbone, it's something you can't play about with, Rob. You can't go back too early, another knock, and you could miss the rest of the season. I think Alan Johnson just been fouled there. He's a key player. Sunderland of late for me, from what I've been told, I've been missing their width. And Johnson certainly on his game is as good as anyone in this stand in this league. Johnson and Gray on that left-hand side have an almost telepathic understanding, which was evident as they made their returns together in the reserves against Leeds in midweek. Butler up from the back with a header. And Titus Bramble having to clear. Heavy responsibility on the shoulders again of young Bramble, who's just 17 years of age. Did so well on his debut against Sheffield United and has made a couple of appearances from the subs bench since then. Today's a massive game for him, isn't it? And, you know, it's a great learning curve for him, you know, against now Quinn, the big target experienced man. And then little Phillips, who's totally different. Here's Naylor. Natural quality finisher, but when you're away from home under the cosh, he'll work the line and he'll close people down for you. Ball, this is Ray, and now make it. Phillips just ahead of him, but he looks inside instead. Challenge from Clapham on Lee Clark. It was interesting to start the programme, you know, this challenge on Lee Clark, who Sunderland were out for so long, taking a hefty knock there from Clapham. But Peter Reid's had to do without, you know, several key players throughout the season. And 7 points clear, quite incredible. In fact, well, 3 points more than what Forest were last year at the same stage of the season. Venus. Naylor. There's Michael Gray. Johnston. Incidentally, the other player who offers them great width on the other side, Nicky Somervie, should be making his return in the reserve sometime this week. And then pretty much normal service will be resumed. Well, that, you know, we're talking strength and depth here. You know, Michael Bridges on the bench. Goodness me, what a prospect he is, and yet can't command, you know, in the starting lineup. Whereas George Burley, I have to say, you know, it's just lately it's been terrible. Haven't they sell good players? Ipswich's got a couple of key injuries, really. There's no strength in depth. Manning George has done a great job, and his hands are tied behind his back at the moment for me. It's a luxury for Sunderland that they can leave their leading scorer this season, Bridges, on the pitch. This is Gray. Interception there from Fabian Vilnis, who's a new face since we saw Ipswich last. Ball is looking for Quinn. Pettis and Quinn having a go there. Pettis is very unhappy, but to be fair, Quinn gets the early jump on him. Pettis is underneath the ball. It doesn't look offside. Maybe Phillips is offside, but look, Quinn gets above him, and Pettis reacts rather angrily. He's going to get a few more of these during this match. Don't worry about that. It's the right arm that's come across Pettis. So Pettis could be a fiery old character. 10 bookings already this season, the latest against Grimsby last week. Oh, now Quinn will use all his experience against them. When you know you've got a fiery centre-half, you intimidate them, you talk to them, you climb all over them. It's only a matter of time before the yellow comes out. Here's Mark Venus, returning to his native northeast, born in Hartlepool and began his career there. This is Vilnis. Jilton, Kieran Dyer. Magilton here looking for Naylor. Good early ball there from Magilton. I don't think Naylor expected it, to be honest. Macon was a full back, round and cover. Good early ball. They had Naylor, it bounced kindly to him as well. It sort of checked on bounce and came back towards him. Couldn't get the right angulation on the left foot strike. Oh, well, it was in a corner, but to the fury of Sunderland, the referee has given them a corner kick. Well, that's quite incredible, isn't it? Because the linesman's aside, you know, what is he thinking about there? And it's Magilton who will take the kick. See again, Rob, the wind. You know, don't be misled, viewers at home, with this lovely sunshine on the far side. There's a wicked wind here at the Stadium of Light. Today's match referee, Eddie Wolstenholme, the man who was in charge at Wembley last summer when Sunderland suffered the disappointment of losing to Charlton in the playoff final after that dramatic game on penalties. Brave man, Rob, I wouldn't mention that word Charlton earlier. Stadium of Light, you know you've got to match Sunderland for the physical side of things. And certainly Naylor, his manager George Burley knows all about Naylor's battling qualities. Gray's cross towards Quinn. Yeah, Quinn, he likes that one, doesn't he? We've seen him do it a few times where he just sort of lofts the ball aiming for the far corner. Have to be good to beat Richard Wright this afternoon. Takes on his chest brilliantly. And the left foot strike, I think maybe Clapham was just close to them there, putting them off.
Well, they haven't had a full season together by any means, but Quinn and Phillips have still got 20 goals between them. And both on the score sheet last week at Loftus Road, when the two of them paired up together once more. Venus. Which twice led here last season. Came away with a 2-2 draw. Bobby Petter, one of their scorers that day, absent through suspension today. And the goal scorer was Kieran Dyer.
You see Sunderland closing down hard there. Clark challenging on Holland there. They realise Ipswich are gifted in the midfield area. Trying to give them no inches.
This is Bramble. Found its way through to Johnson, but the flag up for offside.
I thought Kevin Ball caught Bramble there after the pass was made, but he's such a big lad. You see Ball sliding in and catching him. Just offside. Johnson will make them runs all day.
Well, Sunderland have indisputably been the kings of the Nationwide League so far this season. The most wins, the fewest defeats, the most points and the best goal scoring record of any Nationwide League team. Foul by Kevin Ball.
Just clipping the heels here to David Johnson, trying to get the left foot in the ball from behind, maybe perhaps lucky not to show a yellow, tackle from behind. But that's what he's all about, Kevin Ball, fiery little character.
Saw red at Queen's Park Rangers a week ago, although that decision was later revoked by referee Scott Matheson. Here's Clark. Phillips going through the middle.
Maybe Clark just trying to hit his feet there, you know, trying to just play in his path. But this issue, plenty of blue and white jerseys back there.
Butler.
It's very important, Rob, that when you come, you know, to the stadium, like, you don't sit back too much, defend too deep. You have to play the ball, get up to the strikers and go and support. If you sit back too much, Sunderland just keep coming in waves after waves, and eventually the pressure normally tells with a Sunderland goal.
Well, for so long, Peter Reid's team have been looking over their shoulders and seeing Ipswich just behind them. And Ipswich have now suffered successive league defeats against Grimsby and Wolves, which have left one or two people questioning their automatic promotion credentials.
back to the point I made earlier, Rob, you know, you keep attracting, you're getting rid of players to balance the book, bringing players on loan. You can't expect to get second spot, I don't think. Here's Johnson, trying to work it into the area, but cut out initially by Butler, well won back though by Dyer. What a great example of the strength that he offers. Vilnius here has done well to try and work his way through. Holland! So Holland is good. As you see, Rob, good work from the fullback Vilnius. But Holland does pick his runs really well. I was nearly going to say he's a typical John Watt run. He's got a bit to go to match John Watt, but that's a great run into the box after good work from Vilnius on the right-hand side. Picks himself up, whips it in, and a glancing header off target. George Burnley knows how close they were to prizing them open then. The eventual header was well off target, but he'll be pleased with the move that led to it. Vilnius, a player who was brought in for a fee, despite the fact that he would have been out of contract at his Dutch club, De Graafschap, in the summer, but they needed someone to replace the sold Maurizio Tirico, and Vilnius now plugging that hole. You can see Ipswich, the way they're taking quick free kicks. They fancy getting after Sunderland here, getting at them early on in this match. Dyer, Magilton, Johnson, and Dyer taking over. Dyer on his right foot, but he is a player I like, Rob, and he's the key to his game, I think. His fitness is tremendous, great engine. He's got quick feet. He does love to go and support the front players, trying to strike from, what, 25 yards, and that won't trouble Sorensen. But this guy's got a great engine, and you just feel it's only a matter of time when he steps up in the Premier. Will it be Ipswich, or will it be another star they have to let go? Ipswich possession-wise, you can see 55% taking the game to the home side. And the efforts that George Burley's side have mustered so far have been off target, but at least they're breaking through, putting themselves in good positions. Similar last year here, Rob, when Ipswich come up here, got an early goal, I think 8 minutes, had a fantastic first half, and Sunderland picked himself up, and it was like the Alamo second half. Ipswich couldn't get out of the half. Gray under pressure from Naylor. Here's Vilnius. Through the game, I think that Ipswich are desperate to come away with. 1 point will be a great result. If you look at the, you know, Bolton's and Bradford, what a job Paul Jewell's doing there. Fantastic. They're all breathing down each other's necks now, apart from Sunderland. Points better off than they were after 27 matches of last term, but of course the tradition in recent seasons for them has been to start slowly and finish strongly. It was as part of that strong finish last year that they actually cost Sunderland dear with a 2-0 victory at Portland Road that effectively prevented Sunderland from gaining automatic promotion with Nottingham Forest. Magilton. Bramble. This is Mark Venus. Johnson. Cleared by Melville. Clark there ahead of Magilton, just caught by the new man. Interesting to see how Lee Clark fares today. Certainly bundled off. Magilton just missed timing it. But Clark out for so many months. Recovering from injury now, back in. And it, you know, for me, he's not a pacey type player, is he? He's great on the ball. And I just wonder how much that layoff's affecting him. Looking forward to seeing him play a full 90 minutes today. Venus, Magilton, Holland. This is Dyer. Gray forcing him across the pitch, doesn't quite reach Johnson. Ray in the way. Phillips. Bacon. You look at Sunderland's forward players. Well, of course, they miss young Kevin Phillips. Fantastic player, you know, great goal against QPR. Now, according to the experience, then you look at Dicchio on the bench, Bridges on the bench. If only a team like, you know, Ipswich had that sort of strength and depth. Mind you, I don't think there's any other First Division club, Rob, that can have four strikers like that. Ball. Clark. Spinas, who's conceded the throw. Sunderland just starting to step it up past the quarter-hour point. Is making. Great challenge from Johnson. He's bustled his way clear of making. Dyer. Naylor just sitting on the shoulder of the defender, Melville. Just wonder if Naylor was dropping in an offside position, but that's what Dyer is so good. He's as soon as he's seen Johnson possession, sparking off the front players, using the good legs, the quick, the speed to get up and support the front players. Fettis using Quinn for leverage. To be honest, I think Quinn, he's got about 6 inches on this fella. You can see the arm across and the other one. There's a nasty challenge now. I think Magilton could be in trouble. Magilton is in trouble. Eddie Wilson-Hearn pulling him out of the crowd. It was a bit nasty, Kevin Phillips going down in a bundle. That's the type of player Magilton does like to, you know, it's actually not Magilton, it's a Bramble or Thetis with a nasty looking challenge from behind. I think it's Titus Bramble who could be in trouble. Titus Bramble showing the yellow card. He does like to, you know, this fella, he doesn't hold back. When he sees a ball, he goes to challenge, you know, you can't coax young defenders into tackling. This fella, sometimes I think, has to ease off a little bit. He's certainly coming right behind Phillips. Now he's got to be very, very careful. Sunderland's immediate concerns allayed with Phillips up again. What can Johnston and Gray work from the free kick? Aiken. Quinn. Delivered across by Paul Butler. I think now Quinn will be well aware of Ipswich's tremendous defensive record. Sunderland, for me, you know, last year they were very cavalier, home and away, Rob. Attack, attack, attack. I think they're beginning to learn a little bit this season that sometimes, you know, you have to sit on leads. I think they're going to have to be patient today. Naylor. Team in the division with a better defensive record than Sunderland. So hurling this one in. The head of ball. Magilton. Vilnis. A hopeful one from Magilton. Adventurous there. First of all, there was Quinn and Naylor. Swirling ball, you know, any balls in the box. And you can see Naylor going for making there. Eight clean sheets in the last 10 games for Thomas Sorensen. Be away here from Bramble. Just leaning back, wasn't he, Ray? Just seemed to hesitate in hitting it. Just leaning back with the left foot. Not troubling Richard Wright. Phillips was there. Ray got the first touch. Look at the time he's got here. On the left foot, keeps his head down, just leans back. Phillips makes the run across him, gets on his left, blasts away, goes for power. Wright doesn't even go for the ball. Johnston. Could have spelt problems, but it comes back off Thetis. does look through that middle of the picture of it, does look a little bit bobbly there. Fettis. This is Magilton. Naylor. Sticking tight to him was Paul Butler, who's decided that his international ambitions lie with the Republic of Ireland, despite interest from Wales. Magilton. Down the line by Naylor. Definitely just a little bit of sparkle missing from Sunderland this afternoon. We've seen them so many times here at the stadium, like, dominate teams, but it's not happening so far. We haven't seen too many daring raids up the left-hand side with Graeme Johnston. Well, it was those two players, really, who terrorised Ipswich for the opening spell of the match at Portland Road earlier in the season. Indeed, it was build-up between Graeme and Johnston that led to the opening goal for John Mullen. Gray. Now Johnston. This is Butler. David Johnston. Ball snapping away at him. Magilton. Oh, a missed kick from Thetis that's put them under real pressure with three up. It's Kevin Phillips. And Alex Ray, oh, he's lifted it away from goal.
Oh, what a lightning break. Ray had to make a more solid touch on the ball. Richard Wright diving. But Thetis takes his eye off the ball here. And suddenly, Clark bursts through. He's not got the pace to get away from Thetis. Wide to Phillips. Phillips takes it. First touch wide. Goes for the cross, and Ray over the top. I think if Phillips' touch had been better there, I think he'd have gone his own. Tries to find Alex Ray, does. Wright's presence there, and over the top from Ray. Reedy can't believe it. Best chance of the match.
Well, Thetis a very relieved man after his missed kick put his own side under pressure, but Matt Holland is in trouble with Eddie Wolstenholme for that challenge on Alex Ray.
Well, Holland was late, but he's not that type of player, Rob. He was late, there's no doubt. Ray gets there first. You see Holland going for the ball and catches him right down the shin. That's got to be a yellow card. Some of the Sunderland players reacting angrily that Kevin Ball was over quickly. And that does look nasty from that angle.
Well, Kevin Ball, who was the peacemaker when other Sunderland players went to try and confront Holland, was there again as he's shown the yellow card.
Well, Ball reacted very well there for captain, stopping Butler getting to Holland. But Ball himself, well, he knows what challenges like that are all about.
Makin's free kick. Cleared by Bramble, then by Dyer.
Whistling and booing going on here as Bramble cleared the ball. He sees, he finds a funny side of it. Now Quinn doesn't. I think going back, you know, Bramble does get a good, you can see it's clearly flicked on there, there's an offside decision. Bramble gets in front of Quinn. Quinn tries a little kick at the ball. But going back to that challenge, Rob, Holland on Ray. Players know each other well, and they know that he knows Alex Ray can be nasty and put his foot in too. He's probably trying to protect himself, but from the second angle we've seen, it was a nasty challenge. Deservedly, yellow card. Clark. Venus. Clapham. Johnston. Dyer to Holland. Well, he's fouled by Ball. Classic football match so far, but it's a great contest, especially in this midfield area. Clapham, Dyer,
Here's Magilton. Vilnius. Cleared by Butler. Magilton. Vilnius. And Magilton has, well, he appeared to have done well there by releasing Vilnius, but a flag up for offside. Catching offside, but Vilnius, when he plays, when this ball's through, look at the four Sunderland players in the line, all hunting the ball, trying to deny Ipswich's space, and Johnson right through the middle was certainly offside. Phillips. Now Johnson, while Phillips and Quinn go into the box, and ball waits at the edge. It's Niall Quinn! Goal number 12 for him for this season! And a vital breakthrough for Sunderland.
Well, what a goal. Now Quinn, positional sense is brilliant. He doesn't even jump here. The ball is so good from Johnson. He gets in behind Venus. What a great goal. He's about 2 inches off the ground, directs a header past Richard Wright. Great ball in from Johnston. Quinn doesn't miss from 5 yards. Wright can do nothing. 1-0. Great goal. And Sunderland get the breakthrough. This time Reedy jumps up and can celebrate.
And he jumps for joy because he knows what they've been missing in the absence from the team of Alan Johnston. And that has just been perfectly demonstrated. Quinn the beneficiary.
Great positional sense, Rob. As soon as Johnson cut in his right foot, he's aiming for the far post. And the ball was inch perfect, wasn't it? Venus can do nothing. Quinn heads for goal. There's a left hand on it, but not strong enough.
Johnston here was looking to get through again. There were some appeals that Bramble had actually handled it in the build-up to it, but Johnston reacted quickly.
Once again, it's not a bad touch. Just can't get out of his feet, Johnston. But he's so good with both, with either foot. You know, he can go down the left and whip them in, but for the goal, cut double back on his right foot. Tremendous ball to the far post.
Of that goal, and now Quinn has put Clark through.
Good defender from Holland, he didn't dive in first time. Clark covering the ground, good hold up play from Niall Quinn. Clark arrives, it's a good play. This is Venus, just falls over there. But watch Holland, he doesn't dive in, he times it right. Corner.
Well, there was a tentative opening to this game by Sunderland, but the early indications are that that goal might allow them to revert to their old swashbuckling style. As Ray gets it across, ball went for it. Johnston, who's provided a goal from across already, doesn't tease his way past Vilnius this time. Gray, though, delivers.
That's back from Richard Wright. Big question for the game, Rob, was would Ipswich Town miss Tony Mowbray? And yeah, some people might feel, yeah, he'd have got that, but I think the service, the ball from Johnston, would have beaten any centre-half.
An irresistible combination in the Sunderland front line. But even without it, only three teams this season have prevented Sunderland from scoring against them. Bradford, Birmingham, and the only one they lost at Tranmere.
I was just saying probably 10 minutes ago now, Rob, that down the left, Sunderland weren't really getting, making inroads with Gray and Johnson. And Vilmos was doing well. He was getting forward finishes. Johnson certainly had a beat to the full-back a few moments ago. Problem this fella faces, Johnson can skip round outside past him with the left foot, or he can double back right for the goal with the right foot. Great quality, having two quality, good foot, you know, for a winger. Right or left foot. Ipswich, they won't be intimidated. Look at this, 34% in Sunderland's half. But Sunderland have the all-important breakthrough. Gray, Johnston, Phillips. Kevin Ball. Johnson. Off the back of Gray. Johnston last for the Ipswich throw. Sunderland have gone now over 8 hours without conceding a goal here. Venus. And Naylor is free at the right of the penalty area. Yeah, Venus has spotted him as well, Rob. Couldn't find them.
Ray. Make it. There's that second goal. Is it going to be a killer? He's turning out after going to come out, take chances, gamble, try and get themselves back in this match before half time. Clark. Given away by Thetis to Clark, but Clafford recovers. Top class, Holland unlucky. He needs a bit of help here, Rob. It's a great run from Clark. Holland gets there first. Now he's looking for some support, but unfortunately falls to Quinn. And he just bends and curls it in. Reedy needed a second before half-time, now he's got it. Magilton. Here's Dyer. Clapham. Foul by Ray. Ray, but he's got a problem with discipline, you know. That's the way he likes to play, but you can see it's a follow-through with a left foot. That catches Jamie Clapham. Ray, moments earlier, took a heavy knock from Matt Holland, and suddenly now it's his turn to go in the boot. No need for that. Sunderland's first caution. Follow the two collected by Ipswich players. He was actually an Ipswich fan as a youngster back in Glasgow, Ray. No fan there. Venus with a kick. taking responsibility in his own penalty area that time. Vilnius. Cleared by Butler. Strong possession again to Ipswich, despite two goals behind Sunderland, but you can't afford to take your eye off now, Quinn, for 1 minute. Dyer. Magilton. Peters. Gilson. Layla. And the hit for Dyer, who made a useful run down the channel. Well, a reminder of the action we've got coming up for you from the Premiership later. Charlton, the team who beat Sunderland in that playoff final against Newcastle. It's on Sky Sports 1, and our coverage starts at 3 o'clock. And maybe Charlton will win a few friends back here if they beat Newcastle today. Here's Ray. Made off by Phillips towards Clark, but it's Magilton who's there. Clapham. Magilton.
A minute there, Sunderland got a little bit square. Michael Gray and Andy Mel were square. Naylor made a good run, and Magilton's ball for them a little bit better. They could have been in trouble. They've just got a little bit agitated, the crowd here at Stadium of Light, but suddenly two goals. And big Niall Quinn, suddenly it's all smiles.
Naylor. Johnson. Venus, and again Mark Venus, Naylor calling for the early ball in the box, gets it now does Naylor, good intelligent header back as well to Vilnius, now can Holland finish, a bullet of a shot, a cracker of a goal, and Ipswich give themselves genuine hope.
I'll tell you what a finish this is, but it's a great header back from Naylor, Venus with a long ranging ball to the far post, watch this for header back, really pings it back. It's a good layoff from Vilnius, and suddenly Holland from 22 yards, that is a great strike. Venus on the left foot, tries one, Sorensen came and stopped, but this is good build-up. Holland somehow gets up to support Vilnius, but what a strike with the right foot. Great goal, Ipswich Town back in this match, 2-1, Sorensen no chance. And George Burley, this time, we're back in it.
A really thunderous shot from Matt Holland. It's his fifth goal of the season.
I said 15 minutes ago, Rob, this was no classic. This could turn into be some classic.
And here's Johnson. Clapham was up to his left, but he's looked instead to Naylor. Gray gets in the way.
Great ball from Johnson, Rob. Great ball from Dave Johnson. Really put Michael Gray under pressure. End-to-end stuff.
Here's Tettis. Four Ipswich players to his left. Dyer, one of them. Helped out by Holland to Jamie Clapham.
Free kick, dangerous position. I'm sure Venus will come up here with a left foot. Clapham just try to get past Makem. Certainly there's a body check here. Right arm out. Suddenly, with 6 minutes or 5 or 6 minutes remaining, Peter Reid thinking 2-0 up a few moments ago. Now it's a bit nervy.
How quickly fortunes can change in football. He's chewing anxiously at the sidelines now, Peter Reid. Johnson just offering a bit of advice.
Wonder if he's going to try and flip one over the wall here, or maybe to get on the end of maybe Bramble's head back.
Johnson's made his run now, It went towards Thetis, and it's come off a defender for a corner. Rob Morney's holding his head. What a chance this is from Thetis. Great ball in. Look at this. What a chance that is. 7 yards out. He's only got to make contact. No one near him. And you can see just what an impact the wind is having. This up here end of August. It's Jamie Clapham's corner. Clark. Phillips. The ball to Clark. Willis intervened. He played a big part in the goal as well, getting up to support. The headed back from Naylor. Johnston. This is Quinn. Butler. Johnston! And right, at full stretch, tips it around. Fabulous stuff. Great header from Ray. Jamie Clapham gets on his heels. Look at Ray's header. And what a good strike this is. Richard Wright, maybe going to hit the post, couldn't take a chance. Here's Ray's corner. Magilton it is who gets it away, and Dyer up here against Gray. Really tested Gray's resolve there. So obviously see the pace of Dyer there, because Gray is no slouch. Dow was making ground up hand over fist. Michael Gray. Johnston.
Leave it.
Melville. Just think, Peter Ehan must be feeling, Rob, you know, that second of now Quinn's goal's going in, he must have thought, lovely. Right, we'll have a nice cup of tea and we'll come out, we'll keep it tight. And suddenly, what a great goal from Holland. And here's danger. And Phillips just knocked out of his stride, was he? Well, they're all looking at the referee, Rob. Richard Wright makes his mind up here incredibly quick. He comes racing off his line. As Phillips sneaks in behind the Ipswich defence. It's really just a long punt, isn't it? Flicked on, but watch Wright, he's racing out his goals, and I don't think that's a penalty at all. I think the little fella realised, good flick on from Quinn. I think little Phillips realises his touch is not good enough. It's good goalkeeping, no contact, goal kick. Well, Wright's conceded a couple of penalties this season. We saw him concede one on the opening day against Grimsby, which he then subsequently saved. He conceded one against Watford as well, which he didn't save. But he made his mind up, Rob, didn't come, stay, had to stop halfway, committed himself. And I think that took little Kevin Phillips by surprise. Aiken. Both going for the same ball. It's Johnston who's emerged with it. Again, they're looking at the referee. But nothing judged illegal about the Vilnius challenge. Tell you what, Rob, there's no way I thought the Phillips won. But first impressions here, this is bad defending for me. And I thought someone might have had a case. It's a long, long ball from Ray, wasn't it? And suddenly Vilnius getting back. Let's have a look. Wow, Johnston does cut across him. There's contact. But I think as Johnston cut across him, maybe that's why the referee was 50-50. Couldn't decide yes or no. Well, he decided though, didn't he? Vilnius, you know, that's once or twice now. He's just getting caught the wrong side of Alan Johnson. He's trying to get forward so much that he's forgetting his defensive duties.
A minute of stoppage time then to be added.
Makin's free kick. Jilton. Venus. Jilton suddenly seemed as though he had nowhere to go, got himself out of it well. This is Clapham. And now Dyer. Lovely touch to Holland. Could it be another blockbuster? Very nearly was.
Sorensen this time, I think it's his right hand. He stretches over just to touch this away. Great play from Dyer. Just slips it there to Holland. Holland, hardly any backlift. Look at the square. And that's just a fingertip keeping away from that far corner from Sorensen. George probably thinks he's going in at half time for a couple and 2-2. Unfortunately, time's up.
It's all happening. Andy Melville was booked just before half-time, but Matt Holland really has given Ipswich great hope in this contest at the halfway stage after Niall Quinn seemed to have put Sunderland in such a commanding position with two goals inside 6 minutes. The first benefiting from the return to the team of Alan Johnston. Wonderful cross that Quinn buried. And the second one, perhaps a little touch of fortune about it as the cross from Clark escaped from right. Holland intervened and then could only get a touch to it as Quinn put it back in, but Holland at the right end with a real thunderous effort that means we still have very much an even-handed contest on our hands. Quite a second half in prospect here then at the Stadium of Light. Sunderland lead Ipswich 2-1 at half-time.
Half-time at the Stadium of Light. Sunderland lead Ipswich by the odd goal in three. Terrific first 45. 16 attempts at goal, 5 on target. And Ipswich really giving as good as they get so far. Four bookings, Ray and Melville of Sunderland, Bramble and Holland for Ipswich. And the action areas prove the point I was just making. Look at that. And Ipswich have had a lot more of the ball as well. Three wise men to assess the first 45. The Birmingham manager, Trevor Francis, has joined Ray and Nigel. Trevor, you want a Sunderland win from a Birmingham point of view. Nip and tuck at the moment, though, isn't it?
Ipswich have done well, despite the fact that without a couple of important players in Mowbray and Petter, they've adopted a very adventurous approach, and they started the game very well. And unfortunately, they found themselves two goals behind, rather against the run of play. But they've hit back well, and they're certainly back in the game now.
You're a big fan of Ipswich, as we keep saying, Ray. You're proud of their performance so far?
I think it's been a wonderful performance. I think they've done ever so well. They've taken the game to Sunderland. And what you have to do with Sunderland is retain the ball. And that will quieten the fans down. Once you get into a dogfight with Sunderland, then you've got problems. But I think in the middle of the park, they've been exceptional. I think Holland and Dyer have been great.
Well, we spoke about Niall Quinn before the game. His goal last week at Queen's Park Rangers was his first in 8 games. But Nigel, he's popped up with 2 in the first 45 today.
He has. It's a wonderful header, but it's the cross that makes it. Alan Johnson, keeper can't come for this, Richard Wright, and now pulling away at the far stick. It's a good header, and we've seen him do that many, many times. Mark Venus hasn't got a hope with that ball. It's just a wonderful cross.
Trevor, you spoke about the threat that Johnston was going to cause as well.
Yeah, most of the problems for Ipswich have come down their right-hand side. I think Johnston has done well, and that's where they got him for the second goal. I think it's a reorganised Ipswich back five. They haven't played together before. They've got a new right wing-back in Wilness. Bramble was playing on the right-hand side, and they've certainly missed, I think, Mowbray's calming influence at the back.
The second goal for Sunderland could have been the killer blow. Are they a little bit unfortunate over this one, Nigel?
I think they were unfortunate to go two goals down anyway, but this one, Richard Wright makes the save, and then Matt Holland, tracking back, gets in his way, really, because I think he's going to gather this. As the cross comes in, it's low, Richard's going out, he's pushed it out, and this, he could have collected it, or Matt Holland pushing, they got in each other's way, and Niall Quinn just puts it in.
Actually, Holland was somewhat punished there for his honesty. He has tracked back well, and I think Wright would have probably gathered that ball.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Well, a lot of teams sort of folded at that stage, but Ipswich keep coming back, right, don't they? They are playing this neat football. They refuse to be intimidated in what is a very intimidating atmosphere.
Yeah, what they're doing, I think they're sitting Holland and Majorton in the middle of the field and allowing Kieran Dyer to do what he wants. And Kieran's finding a little air in behind the Sunderland midfield section, and he's looking very, very positive indeed. And they thoroughly deserve to get back in the game.
Well, we have an offering for goal of the month as far as the Ipswich strike is concerned. Matt Holland, who, as we said before, the game is so... consistent, 93, I think, games in a row. Yes, he doesn't do that too often.
But this is a fantastic strike. Thomas Sorensen, no chance. But Naylor makes it. What a header back that is. and it's laid off into the path of Matty Holland, and what a strike with the wind.
It's actually interesting. If you look at the position here, Kevin Ball, who does a good job, you know, in front of the back four, he tries to read the intentions of Wilnis, trying to protect Alan Johnson, thinking he's going to go past him. If he had stayed with Holland, I think possibly the goal could have been avoided.
The other question, should Matt Holland have been on the pitch at that point? There was a pretty nasty challenge there on Alex Ray, Trevor.
Well, it was, and there are referees possibly who would have given a red card. We didn't particularly want that, of course, you know, because of the unfair contest, 10 against 11, but it was a nasty challenge, it really was.
Ray, and you said in Italy he would have been off straight away, wouldn't he?
He would have been off. Once you raise your foot in Italy, then it's a free kick anyway, but once you lay a challenge in on someone like that, you'd been off the field.
A couple of other controversial moments just near the end. Sunderland thought they should have had two penalties. Let's have a look at both of them. First of all, Kevin Phillips threw. Richard Wright, was that a foul?
No penalty, no. Good flick on from Niall Quinn. Phillips in behind, but I think he knocks this actually too far, it goes out of play. I don't think he would have got it. But Richard Wright, I don't think he's really caught in there, and I think Kevin Phillips is honest enough to say, you know.
And then Wilkins and Johnston, Trevor.
Well, once again, you know, for me it's not a penalty. Johnston goes over, but no, nothing wrong with that. I think the third time though it might be one.
We shall see. We shall see. At half time at the Stadium of Light, Sunderland lead by 2-1. Are they going to extend their lead at the top of the First Division, or can Ipswich continue the comeback? We're back in a couple of minutes. At half-time, the First Division leaders Sunderland lead Ipswich by 2-1. Now then, Trevor, any reason to change your mind? You went for a Sunderland win before the start. Have Ipswich impressed you so much that you want to change your mind?
No, they've done very well, but I'll still stick with the home win. I think that you know, Ipswich are not quite as watertight at the back as what they normally are. I've spoken about the loss of Mowbray. It's an inexperienced back division, and new together, and I think that there are more goals in it for Sunderland.
Nigel, you're still going for a home win?
I am, but I've been pleased that Ipswich have played so well and they've got back into this game. It's going to be a good second half, but I've got to stick with Sunderland.
You backed the draw before the start, Ray.
Yes, I did.
Could have been an inspired choice.
Yeah, I think the first 20 minutes of the second half is vitally important. If Ipswich don't concede in that 20 minutes, then I think we could get that draw.
OK, it's back to our commentators, Alan Brazil and Rob Hawthorne.
It'll be interesting to see how Ipswich set out their stall at the start of this second half, but that goal from Matt Holland, Alan, has certainly given them a lot of hope.
Without a doubt, you know, Peter Reid, I think, was looking rather comfortable now, Quinn, when he got his second goal. Interestingly then, Reedy went down on the bench, didn't he? So I think the message was, come on, let's hold it, let's hold them till half-time. Fortunately for Ipswich, Holland, that was a great strike with his right foot, and he's been a real battler for Ipswich this afternoon, so we're in for a cracking second half.
A save from Sorensen prevented Holland from getting a second strike, otherwise we could already have been level. Lee Clark and Kevin Phillips, the two major absentees through injury for a large part of this season. Getting the second period underway, and Alan Johnston, who's already delighted on his return with that quality cross for the first goal. This is Gray. I think great half-time was dead right. The first 15 minutes are so important for Ipswich. They can't afford to concede a third. Will they come out at Sunderland? Will they have a go at them, or will they sit and be patient, try and quieten down the crowd, and then hopefully the last 15 minutes for George Burley put a little bit of pressure on Sunderland, looking for this equaliser. Burley, former Sunderland player, although their surroundings now are somewhat different to his days with the club.
It's very interesting reading the programme as well. A little profile on Eric Gates, who does a lot of media up here on Sunderland. He's a great Ipswich player, and yeah, he's pumped for Sunderland today. He says, no, I'm Sunderland through and through. Very surprising.
Seems to have picked up at the start of this second half. And no foul there against Vilnis, and in comes Kevin Ball, but was lacking in support. Too many players behind him still appealing for the free kick for the earlier challenge on Lee Clark. And he's clutching his right knee. Everyone seemed to stop. The referee said, no, play on. And then Clark receives the attention. Let's hope this is not serious. And Clark's already had that one serious injury, breaking his leg on the opening day here against Queen's Park Rangers.
Yeah, everyone seems to stop here. You can see it's a high challenge from Vilnis, and that studs just below the knee.
off, at least temporarily. The illness was late, there's no doubt about it. See Clark getting there first. Three players with Jilton in there as well. He's all right. He's not got the best legs in the world, has he? He was riding ponies for 6 years when he was young. Jamie Clapham with the throw. Here's Holland. Fettis. It's ball. Phillips. Now Vilnius. Dyer. Jilton. Tell you what, that's a bad one, Rob. He could be in trouble on a tick, Alex Ray. Sunderland might just be down to 10 in a minute. Depending how the ref looked at that. Well, it's going to be a long, anguished wait. Well, the fact that the ball has been in play takes some of the sting out of it. Phillips here could get a third. Quite incredibly, Phillips was through there, but the wind held the ball back. Right, referee, what's he going to do? Just going to have a little look at Mark Venus now. It's a good through ball. The ball doesn't run, it just checked there for him. Well, he's calling Alex Ray towards him. Ray saying, who me? But it was definitely a late challenge. And this is touch and go for Alex Ray. Again, it's the follow through the left leg. And perhaps because of Holland's challenge on Ray early on, he stayed on the pick. Alex Ray, I think, has had a final warning. Very much a final warning. Here's Quinn. Jilton, Fettis. Just think of that challenge again, Rob. The referee got a terrible reception at half-time coming off the pitch from the Sunderland fans. Felt maybe there was two penalties, but clearly on the replays we can tell them, you know, that there wasn't a penalty there. Maybe he's just feeling a little bit, you know, his ears are still ringing from that reception, and he didn't send Alex Ray off. He's exactly Mr. Popular again now, having punished that challenge. To me, if he got the ball, to be honest. Ray getting back there, nothing to do with him, it's making. Venus with the kick. And it's Clapham. The wind's blowing right into the Sunderland players' faces here. And that must give Ipswich a lot of confidence, you know, with the wind at the backs. Naylor trying to get in the end of it here. Clapham arrives late, and it's always going wide. Jamie Clapham yet to register a senior goal in his career. There's Fettis. Handball by Phillips. 3-4 yards away. No complaints from Phillips. Left arm used. I just feel Sunderland need a little bit more drive in midfield, Rob. Likes a ball and Clark. We've got to start pushing Ipswich back a bit. There's Town at the moment. Must be quite happy with this second half start to it. Well, it was 3 goals in an 11-minute spell in the first half that's given Sunderland their lead, but it was after a good spell of Ipswich pressure that Sunderland made their first breakthrough. Here's Phillips. Make it. Now Clark. And a lovely layup from Quinn. And Phillips will be wondering how that one got away. And also Fettis and Venus will be wondering how he got away. There's two of them against him. And Quinn's always going to win flicks, isn't he? It's a good ball from Clark. Look at Phillips on his way. Past Fettis and Venus. That should have been for me. Game, set and match. That should have been the third goal. Great little quick, you know, quick flick from Niall Quinn, and that's a whisker past the post. I'm sure Reedy's almost out of his seat. Phillips thinks, here we go, 3-1. And normally they go in for him. Not this time. I'm a much would you have put on Kevin Phillips burying it in that sort of situation normally? That was an example of the great strength of this little and large partnership, which has been so fruitful for Sunderland in the last couple of seasons. And again here, Quinn and Phillips combining. Ray had to be very careful with his challenges. This is Clapham. Dyer's left it to Vilnius. And Vilnius has continued his run, having fed Naylor, but Naylor's just taken it on too far.
Naylor was very disappointed when Abu came on loan from West Ham. He felt he needed his chance. Now he's got his chance. Scowcroft still out for 2-3 weeks, trying to just cut in. He feels that Butler has committed himself, but he's given himself a lot to do, and Butler in command, just seeing it out.
Johnson. Clapper. Dyer is available for the short ball. Here is Kieran Dyer. And it's Holland again.
But you know, Holland, he doesn't really have any follow through. What his golf's like, because he seems to just hit it and he stops. You know, it's a short back lift he has. Dyer just says, go on then, let's see you get a second one. He sort of just stabs at them, drills them. Well wide this time.
Net in spectacular fashion in the first half. Kevin Phillips.
He's beginning to find some space now, Phillips. He's drifting off. He's playing in between two centre-halves, drifting off. Seeing a lot more of the ball.
Well, Phillips may well have made contact, but it was a very flamboyant fall from Vilnius.
It's foreign, isn't it? Well, they don't just go down, do they? They've got a three triple cycles and a double roll.
Phillips just getting back, getting a toe in. Yeah, catches him, but look at this. Holland. Dyer, now Johnston. Gray. Clark. Quinn. Broken by Magilton. Pushed by Clark. And I thought he showed it, Clark did. Mr. Russo says no. This is Johnson. Holland had again turned up in a useful position, but it was just beyond him. There's Titus Bramble. Venus. Well, it needed a good ball from Naylor to Clapham.
He tried the first time pass, but you can listen to the Sunderland crowd now. They know that. Thought goal wins this game at the moment, if she's still very much in it.
Good goal aside, has served a useful purpose in frustrating their opponents so far, and that anxiety has spread to the crowd.
And George have been very disappointed the last couple of weeks. I know it's been a few hard training sessions at Portman Road this week. They're certainly getting the response. Still 2-1 down though.
Well, they haven't lost three league games on the trot since they were in the Premiership, when they had that horrendous 8-game losing streak that effectively sealed their relegation fate.
And Trevor Francis was saying earlier, you know, if they were to lose this one, suddenly the confidence begins to dwindle, a few hard games, you know, coming up, and suddenly it's so tight, you know, from second down to sixth, you can't afford to have a bad run this time of the year.
Great. Both teams with important cup engagements looming, and a mini break from league action up and coming. Sunderland involved in that Worthington Cup semi-final with Leicester, and Ipswich with a difficult trip to Everton to face in the FA Cup. Possibility here for Holland, and
He and Johnson left it to each other before Holland eventually had the strike.
Sunderland must be raging here. Sorensen should be absolutely raging with his defenders. Watch this touch from Dyer. It's brilliant. It's a great combination. Lovely little touch. Look at the time he has here. He takes it again, takes his time, and again. Still, look, the goal opens up for him. That's bad defending.
Another end Ipswich here. Conceded a corner. In fact, he's given the free kick for the challenge by Thetis, and it's Alex Reyes taking it. In comes Quinn, just beyond him. Going on for the hat-trick, remember. Gray, Johnston. Lovely link up again between the two left-sided players. Gray's cross. Holland trying to get in there. Phillips aiming to work it through towards Butler.
That was a great header out.
And this time Quinn could be through.
It's a great header out, Rob, initially from David Johnson back there, helping Ipswich out. But Quinn didn't have to go for that ball there. They've just taken a chance, gambled, let it bounce. Kevin on it. It's a good ball. Look at Johnson back in the defender from Ipswich with that header. And suddenly the ball goes in. If she's trying to push out as quick as possible. Their spirits after the pressure they've been under so far in this second half. Phillips. Venus just giving him a rattle from behind there. Complaining Kevin Phillips to the referee. Still be ruined that missed chance, Rob. Golden opportunity, and normally snaps him up. Making is taking it. Quinn and Johnston have been joined at the edge of the area by Butler. Venus underneath it. Gray. Clark. And Quinn. Good effort. And Richard Wright holds on.
Great save. But what a great first touch from now Quinn. Anyone thinks this fella is just a big target man's dreaming.
Butler eventually falls to. Bends it with the right foot. And down to his left, Richard Wright. Gallons at a second attempt.
Johnson. Dyer. Bramble. Now Venus. Good link up between Venus and Clapham. Naylor coming in and gets the deflection.
Well, they were screaming there at the linesman saying the ball had gone out, but the linesman was 3-4 yards away. Naylor got across the defender. I think it came off Butler's shoulder. Good ball on the left foot of Venus. And good cover there from Butler. Keeping tight to Naylor. Does it go out? No. You can see the linesman there, 3 yards away, but this is a good ball in the box. Naylor gets across Butler, almost.
In comes Magilton's corner. Clears everyone though. Quinn. Holland.
Just holding off Bramble. And then Butler with the, you know, outside of his right foot, could have troubled the goalkeeper even more.
Bacon. Clark. Gray. See Johnston. Just moving into position behind the inexperienced
Brambleino playing against Bignall Quinn, because he's so experienced with his movement, his positional sense, and the first goal was a classic for Quinn.
Sunderland making a change. Alex Ray is the player who's coming off. Their leading goal scorer this season is coming up, Michael Bridges, who's got 12, five of which have come when he's come on as a substitute.
Well, we're talking about young Grambo experience. This guy will give him something to think about as well. Bridges, tremendous skill and pace. I think very unlucky not to be in the side. Great. Bridges immediately looking to get involved in the action. He must be disappointed, Rob, but then again, when you've got Quinn and Sparkling Form and Phillips, where can you play him? That's the problem. He's very popular here, is Michael Bridges. Ipswich here flooding forward with Dyer. Holland, Vildesat to his right. Three in the box here for Ipswich, if he can get it right. Well, almost, Rob, almost. Fabulous break on, you know, on the counter. And to be honest, Johnson made a great run. Look at Johnson's run. Leaves all this space here. Holland again upside his mate Dyer. And if Vilnius's ball's a little bit lower, maybe Naylor at the far post could have done something with it. Just trying to bend it in with pace, Vilnius. Loves to get forward, this guy. And just too high for Naylor at the far. Screaming, you must be happy with Bridges on bone for a couple of minutes, been involved in build-ups, but Mark Venus there was screaming at Thetis, and Bramble saying, look, come on, you know, you've got to step up with me. Unfortunately, the wind took the ball out for the Ipswich defence. You see how tight it is. Sunderland still with the lead, 2-1. Watches anxiously as Thetis here has conceded a free kick. Again, he's thinking of the quality maybe from Johnson with the ball in, or Clark, but obviously Quinn's a target. It's played short to Johnston. Make it. Lee Clark. Gray and Johnson wants it played around the back of Butler. The ball was too much, and Kieran Dyer's furious with himself, absolutely furious. He sent Gray out there for an ice cream. That's a great little dummy, isn't it? Look, where's Mickey Gray going there? And Johnson suddenly is bursting in behind the centre half, and only the pace on the ball lets Kieran Dyer down. More evidence of why Kieran Dyer is such a great asset. One that Ipswich are desperate to hold on to, but the more occasions on which they miss out on promotion, the more difficult it is to hold on to that type of player. Also, Tottenham Michael Vierov, honestly, I can remember once in the match when he got to the byline. Normally, it's seven or eight times in the match. He's very quiet getting forward. Magilton. Bridges. Vilas sticking to his guns. Two on Sunderland. Really, really tight, but two now Quinn goals at the moment. just enough to see them in front. He must be thinking of taking that yellow ball home on hat-trick time. Bacon's free kick. Quinn just backing into Thetis. Was he?
No, it's gone the other way. Thetis originally thought he'd got the verdict.
Quinn just sent Thetis. You know, he's been, well, not whinging all the whole game, but he's clearly troubled with now Quinn. You see Quinn, there's a nudge there from Quinn, and again, they've been having a little bit of banter all throughout the match, Thetis and Quinn.
It's a costly piece of banter on Quinn's part because it's been viewed as dissent by the referee.
Goodness me. Because he sort of brushed him with his chest, didn't he? A couple of times. Well, obviously something's been said. You don't get booked for stuff like that. Niall's got to be careful here. He's just got to, you know this is going to be booked, so just leave it. You've got two goals, you're on a hat-trick. Don't spoil it with saying, you know, saying too much.
Well, the explanation is a long one from Eddie Wilstenholme, but there's no changing his mind.
I think it's because Quinn, it could have been what, you know, throwing his arms in there, imitating what Thetis was doing. Maybe it's ungentlemanly conduct. That's perhaps what it's for. He can't believe it though, can he?
Can he channel his anger positively from this free kick? They were somewhat over elaborate from the last one and it all broke down. Right, with cause to be concerned here though. Distinct possibility that this one could be lined up for Johnston. Clark just having a word with him. Ball in attendance too. Alan Johnston. Well, again, they've overdone it.
Johnston. Bridges.
Good delivery in towards Quinn.
It's a real threat now, Phillips. It's Bridges' pace. They're not cutting, you know, Phillips is sharp, but this boy, Bridges, when he gets on a gallop, they won't catch him. He's pacing.
Here's Bridges.
Johnson was offside. This fella time the ball. He loves to just drift into little positions where he's in between two players, no one knows who's marking him. Butler.
And it's gone for the corner.
And up goes Granbo, Thetis and Venus. All piling up the box, searching for this equaliser. And the wind's blown right into Sorensen's face.
Relatively comfortable with this lead for the last 10 minutes or so of Sunderland. But this poses a real threat to them. It's Jim McGilton's latest corner. Holland! It's well blocked, although I think it winded Melville in the process.
Sunderland just looked at it, didn't they? It wasn't a great ball, but Holland made the best of it.
Vilnius. Naylor. Ball gets a toe to it.
The wind's getting stronger and stronger here. Blowing straight down from left to right in your picture.
Here's Clapham. Venus. Gray forcing him back. Holland. This is Vilnius.
Dyer gets it back from Naylor. Melville just floored Naylor as well. It's good possession here from Ipswich.
Naylor's flick on, and it's Quinn who's back there defending. Such is the level of Sunderland's concern.
And Thetis there.
On one or two occasions, he's been left alone and vulnerable. Vilnius. Holland. Clapham.
He's shown great perseverance as Jamie Clapham. For Sorensen, Johnson slid in. And can Sunderland break here with Clark? Phillips and Quinn up ahead, Johnston joining them.
Venus given away to Bridges.
Johnston. Jilton. Gray.
Pete Reed just out his box there, screaming and screaming. Unhappy. The CB's face, he wants another change. There's Big Dickio to add to his aerial problems.
Here's Phillips. Making room for the cross, and Quinn was offside anyway.
Wow, it was a tremendous ball, wasn't it? Great little stab ball in behind Thetis. Quinn peels away again, which he does so well. And to be honest, when that ball was played, that must have been marginal. Quinn stabs away it with the right foot. It must have been marginal when the ball was played.
Sorensen having to be acute with his judgment there against David Johnson's run.
Sorensen a few moments ago, Melville left him in trouble. He managed to, you know, blast the ball away, and yet again, Johnson's a threat with a through ball.
Venus. Cut out by Clark. Ball. Chris Macon. Bridges. Lee Clark, Johnston, now Gray, well, the Sunderland change is imminent. Danny Dickio is ready to come on and can now do so with the ball having gone out for the throw-in.
I think this is not just offensive, I think it's defensive as well, Rob. But with Ipswich pushing, you know, the corners and free kicks, Dickio's another aerial, sorry, very good, strong in the air, Danny Dickio. Whereas Phillips, had he been sharper, the game might have been over 3-1.
Dickio missed the last game at Queen's Park Rangers because of suspension, but returns to action now. Incidentally, 12 of Sunderland's goals this season have been provided by players coming on as substitutes.
I think what's important here for Peter Reid's men is, you know, a home tie against one of the fanciest side in the division. They get full, you know, the full 3 points. Suddenly they're 10 points clear.
Well, after this, they've got 9 home games left in the league. Have Sunderland and of their closest challengers, Bolton, to come here in March, and it's Birmingham here on the final day. And they're able to go into that one still needing points to secure their fate.
Trevor Francis, man, though. Suddenly they're home and dry, clear champions. Birmingham, you know, might just need 3 points.
Jamie Clapper. Bramble. Johnson.
Good intelligent ball from Bramble. Johnson took it well. Butler rather clumsily feels he can get, he can win the ball. Johnson just waits for him. Go on then. Clips it past him. Free kick. Good ball though from Bramble. Intelligent down the side. There's a late challenge. And now a dangerous situation for Sunderland to defend.
We saw Richards just before Christmas. They scored a late goal from a free kick routine. Clapham and Dyer looking for the quality to get them level.
Yes, it's difficult. When the wind's like this, very difficult. Dyer looks on, he's disappointed. But Clapham's just trying to whip it in there with pace. Any touch at all can deflect it in the net.
Sunderland's local rivals are in action later, and you'll see that game from the Premiership live on Sky Sports 1. Our coverage starting at 3 o'clock for Charlton against Newcastle. But will there be Sunderland-Newcastle derbies at the Stadium of Light next season? Certainly, if they can hang on for this victory, a 10-point lead will be a commanding advantage. Their lead has been as wide as 11 points already this year. Indeed, it was Birmingham who prevented them from extending it to 13 with the draw between the sides.
I just feel that Ipswich now are gambling, they're taking chances, they're pushing blue jerseys forward.
Magilton here, trying to place it in for Naylor, but too close to Sorensen.
Ipswich again, slightly ahead. First half, you know, well ahead. It was very tight the second half. I'm sure the wind is certainly playing its part in this match, especially second half. It's got stronger and stronger as Gray, as you can see, tries to clip one up the line.
Afford to give possession away too cheaply. Dyer. Johnson.
It's so tight, Rob, hasn't it? But that could be the difference. Quinn taking his headed chance and nail or not.
Now Bridges. Players to his left hand right, but he's overrun it. Ball up against Holland. Holland again, and Dyer has burst from the midfield to his right. Naylor, and an awkward one from Butler.
Sunderland under pressure now, aren't they? At the other end, with an attack, it's breaking down too quickly, and suddenly Ipswich are flowing forward. Dyer, as you say, made a great run into the box, and Butler, with Dyer right behind him, could only just chuck out his right leg.
Minutes of the match remaining. Can Ipswich get the goal to draw themselves back into the game? Clapham gets a second bite at the cherry. He delivered well, but the header from David Johnson.
Another corner. Really, Michael Gray gave the ball straight back to Clapham from the first corner. Whips it in. Johnson, does it come off a Sunderland player? Didn't look like it. Referee thinks different.
Ipswich will take it though. Magilton
Jilton has picked up the pieces well! And really wasn't too far away.
So I'm quite impressed with Sonnenson in goal, you know, as Jilton lets fly. Sonnenson has a good look at this, doesn't even go for it. Headed over ball, tenacious header against Naylor. It's a big challenge there, but Jilton drives at the far post. You can see Sonnenson in total control. Lifts his right hand up, he knows his angles and his height, and that's well over. George Burley, he doesn't think so. It's closer than that from George's view. Ipswich marginally ahead in terms of their attempts. Dead level in terms of accuracy. The important scoreline, the important statistic is the scoreline, and George Burley's side still needing that breakthrough. Now, George, you need something like this game. You know, I think Ipswich have played so much better in the previous two or three matches. And to come away after having so much possession with no points is disappointing. This could be the sort of springboard again, should they get a late equaliser on the point for the rest of the season. Here's Johnson. But Sunderland don't give too many goals away, Rob, do they? And as you said earlier, Ipswich, the best defensive record, then it's Sunderland. And they're just keeping Naylor and Johnson at bay. Naylor, what a golden opportunity after a great ball from Clapham. Power to the far post. In the end, makes it easy for Sonnenson, but not so easy on his manager. Ipswich at the moment staring a third successive league defeat in the face. Next league action is against Portvale at home after their adventures in the FA Cup against Everton. Perhaps if there is one question mark against Sunderland in the run-in, it's the heavy workload that their cup runs may bring about. They've already played more games than any other side in the First Division. That's why it's so important they must hang on to this, Rob. 10 points, a lovely cushion. And you can get on with the cup games then. The FA Cup game against Blackburn to come, as well as the two legs of that Worthington Cup tie with Leicester. Last time that Sunderland were in the League Cup final, way before Peter Reid's reign, they had an unfortunate Dublin getting to the final and getting relegated. So this year they're hoping for a more positive second side to the coin. Oh, and Dyer there reacts against Clark. No, there's no need for that. Clark, you know, evaded one challenge, then Dyer came across, and maybe, I don't know, maybe it's just a foul. You see Dyer gets in front of him, I'm not sure that's a foul. There's a little bit of handbags in a minute, you know, Dyer turns round, Clark goes down, and luckily players get across quickly, there's no contact, Dyer puts his head forward, but nothing happens, nailing and ball in, no problem. And the referee drew the heat from it, with words and no cards. Gray's free kick. By Thetis. And losing out, it's Lee Clark. Keogh. Bridges. Cleary's first round of the cross, Matt Holland. He trick his way through. Dunbar to get it across to Quinn. And Johnston! Cleared by Venus. I don't know if he was going for the far post or trying to feed it, you know, head it down to Dicchio there, but a good ball from Bridges. I think Bridges quite simply been told, Rob, when you're wide, get half a yard, get it in the box of McQuinney or Dicchio. Just comes back on his left foot, drills it in. Quinn does well again here. Just trying to head it back, Johnson, trying to find Dicchio, I'm sure. Look at Reedy, he's trying not to get in. Can't believe it. Have another bit of gum, Reedy. The three packets in there. Plenty of anxious chewing to go on in the last 3 minutes or so of this contest still, unless they can get the third goal. They have got the corner. gentleman, but he does pose a threat in the air. Along with this fella. Sunderland's set piece have not been so clever this afternoon. What can they do with this one?
Bridges with a corner. Venus getting in the way of De Keo.
This won't mind. Peter Reid won't mind this at all. Keeping Ipswich at bay, 3 minutes remaining. Drilled into the far post. Good header here from Venus.
It's Johnston with the latest corner. And Wright doesn't claim. Dyer. Clark. Quinn. Through to Clark again. Vilnius got his body in the way of it.
No penalty. Three times they've thrown penalties. Vilnius, good, it was good defensive play because Clark was put in with a great little ball from Malcolm. This was a hard fought game. Ipswich must feel a little bit unlucky. Long journey home. Sunderland flying high.
The victory will take them to the 60-point mark. It'll take them there some six matches and nearly 2 months earlier than they reached it in their last promotion year 3 years ago.
I don't think there's any stop on Rob, is there? I think it's a case now who's going to be second and the other four for the playoffs.
Here's Holland.
Caused havoc, big lad. It's a case now of chucking it in the mixer, get it in the box, and be Johnson with the long field goal.
They're bidding out a show midly now for that equaliser. Thetis and Bramble are both in the box as it's hurled in there. Bacon gets the throw off Jamie Clapham.
Fortunate with that tackle. First half to still be on the pitch, Matty Holland. But what a goal he scored.
What a time to equalise this would be at a time of the match where Sunderland would probably be unable to recover. Magilton's corner. Diving header away only goes as far as Kieran Dyer. Great stop from him again.
So he's as fit as a fiddle, but it really is. Disappointing his final cutback there.
He may be on the losing side at the end of it, but Kieran Dyer will at least be taking a bottle of champagne with him back to Suffolk. As voted by our studio panel, he's the nationwide man of the match.
So I'm sure that Roy Wilkins has got something to do with his agent. He loves him.
Well, he's been very involved again as Dyer. The heart of much of Ipswich's good work. Only a minute of stoppage time to be added on. Sunderland are holding on. Can they extend their lead? De Keo. Down on the edge of the area, the challenge from Venus. Nothing doing, says the referee again.
Well, I think Matt in the foul is certainly outside the box. Venus holding his hand up for some reason. Well, there's contact, but no way it was a penalty. Venus misses the ball, yeah, free kick. The last minute he's saying, come on, 10 points clear. Let them catch us. Great result, which is a bit unlucky.
Kevin Ball. Butler. First division into double figures. Peter Reid's team now 10 points clear thanks to a first half double from Niall Quinn. They had their scare when Matt Holland seemed to give Ipswich hope with a blockbuster of a shot before half time,
but in the second half neither team could add to it. Kevin Phillips missed a great opportunity, as did Richard Naylor of Ipswich. So Sunderland go marching on at the top. They've beaten Ipswich here by 2-1.
Well, still to come today on our three Sky Sports channels. Over on Sky Sports 1 next, it's off to the Valley for this week's Super Sunday as Charlton take on Newcastle. That is followed at 6:30 by the third of our live games, Real Betis and Barcelona. And at 9, it's live American football, the AFC Championship between the Denver Broncos and the New York Jets. It's cricket over on Sky Sports 2 tonight from 6:30. Highlights of day 3 of the 5th test between South Africa and the West Indies. That's followed at 8 by highlights of this morning's one-day international between England and Australia. And at 11 tonight, live US Tour Golf, day 4 of the Sony Open. And here on Sky Sports 3 at 5:30, the first of our live games of American football, the NFC Championship, the Minnesota Vikings against the Atlanta Falcons. Let's take a look at the first division table. As a result of Sunderland's victory today, no change in the bottom half. Ipswich were hoping to move from fifth to second, and many will say their performance merited that, but they stay where they were in fifth. Birmingham fourth, Bolton third, Bradford second, and Sunderland now 10 points clear. Let's hear from Niall Quinn and Matt Holland. They're both talking to Alan Bentley.
Matt, if I can start with you, you've lost, but you must be very disappointed indeed.
We are very disappointed. I thought we performed tremendously well today. But the facts are that we've lost 3 in a row now. Sunderland worked very hard, made it very difficult for us, and unfortunately I gifted them the winner.
Well, it was a bit harsh on you, but you did get the goal that brought you back in it as well.
Yeah, probably the hardest chance I had in the game. Managed to put it away, and I had a few more chances which could have brought an equaliser.
Do you agree with the sentiments that it was a hard-fought victory, now?
Yeah, it was. I mean, we were 2-0 up, but reality was we were lucky to be there, because the first 15 minutes, I think they got out of the blocks much faster than us, and it was a little bit difficult for us, but we started to creep into the game, and 2-0, I thought we were comfortable to come up with a wonder goal, and we spent, 50, 60 minutes under pressure, so we're pleased with the win.
Can we just clarify your booking quickly? What was it for?
Well, I was hoping it wasn't for... I thought I was being racist, the lad. I was just copying what he had done for a bit of a laugh, but I was hoping the ref wouldn't see it as racism, but I hope he hasn't either. He said to me that I was taking the mickey out of him, but I didn't mean anything by that. I mean, I'm on the board for show racism, the red card. It wouldn't look too good if I was being booked for being racist, but that was terrible. I felt really bad about that.
Well, thanks for talking to us. Well done, Niall. Hard luck, Matt.
Thank you.
Well, 3 defeats in a row for Ipswich for the first time since April 95. Trevor Francis, the Birmingham manager, has been with us today. Trevor, you wanted a Sunderland win, but did they deserve it?
It wasn't a convincing performance. I think that if they had scored at the start of the second half when Niall Quinn presented Phillips with a great opportunity, then it could have been slightly different. But I think that Ipswich will feel desperately unlucky that they haven't come away with at least a point.
Here are the goals again. Ray, great header by Quinn for the first.
Yeah, but I think, as Nigel said, this is what it's all about, is the cross-in. Now, Johnston didn't get too many balls in today, but that certainly was a wonderful ball. And Niall, the size of him, he just stuck his head on it.
This turned out to be the killer second, Nigel, and as we said at half-time, a little bit of misfortune as far as Ipswich
show. Yeah, I think Sunderland got the break here, and most probably Ipswich didn't get a break the whole game, and that's why they didn't get the point that they deserved. But Matt Holland blaming himself, they're presenting that to Niall Quinn, but I think Richard Wright would have saved that all. If they hadn't got in each other's way, it would have been cleared.
Holland made amends at the other end, Trevor.
Well, Holland and Magilton and Dyer, I thought, dominated the centre and midfield. And that was the key to the game, and I think it allowed Ipswich to play as well as they did. They played with tremendous spirit, passed the ball really well, and I think they'll play far worse than that and come away from an opponent's ground with more than what they got today.
Yeah, they had chances. Just near the end, young Richard Naylor could perhaps have secured a point for George Burley's side. Ray, should he have done better with this one?
Again, like Johnson's ball in the first half, there's Jamie Clapham there getting this one in on his old swinger, the right foot. And I've got to say that Naylor should have put that away.
But presumably you're not writing Ipswich off despite those three successive defeats.
I thought they were fantastic. I thought they thoroughly deserved to be in the game, and how they never got a draw out of it, I do not know. But I thought, Trevor touched on it, I thought the midfield section was exceptional.
Sunderland looked to be home and dry, would you agree now?
I think they played not to 100% today. I thought they were lucky to get the win. But same as Chelsea yesterday, you don't play well, but you get the 3 points, and that's what it's all about. But for Ipswich, they're still right in there. They play extremely well today, and most probably away from home, they'll give anybody a good game.
And from a Birmingham point of view, a very satisfactory afternoon, really, Trevor.
Yeah, I think not just for ourselves, but for the other clubs that are also around us, it was far more beneficial. to us all to see Sunderland get the victory.
OK, Trevor, Nigel Ray, thank you very much indeed. Sunderland have done it again. They are now 10 points clear at the top of the First Division. Bad luck to Ipswich, though. From us all for now is goodbye.
We're gonna shout it to the top, shout. We're gonna shout it to the top, shout. We're gonna shout it to the top, shout.